All right, everyone, welcome to Dark Room. I'm your host, Gene Skinner. I hope we're all having a good night tonight. Let me get the GIF out the way. There we are. We're in the Dark Room proper. Porky is not here yet, but he should be here later, you know, as he is kind of late. That always does happen, you know, work and everything else. But I hope we're all having a good night tonight. I'm just going to open my beer here. I have a hop show. It is a double dry hopped, double hazy IPA, 8.5%. And it's from Beer Zombie. So let's open it up. Nice crack of the can. There we go. And let's pour it in the glass. I'll post a link to where I bought this from. It's from a distributor known as Craft Shack. They happen to be out of California. So there was a few beers I wanted to get from other places that weren't easy to get. So, especially if they're West Coast styled ones. So that's why I ordered from there. No Porky, really. Porky is late. Yeah, I know. I know, Gray. Let's take a look at the can art and where I bought it from. It's about like $7, so it's not too expensive, especially for an 8.5%er. Is that going to load the right way? I don't think it is, but let me see if it does. If it doesn't, I will re-upload that link. Nope, it did not, so give me just a second. That did not work right. So, one moment. Let me open it this way. From Craft Shack itself, so getting the whole Google link. There we go. I'll read a description here, too. It says, this hazy tropical juice bomb is bursting at the seams with mango, peach, pineapple, and rambutan taste. A bright back end of ripe lemon zest brings it together with a pillowy, soft IPA. Don't miss out on this ticket to the hop show. And yes, the can art is definitely a homage to Creep Show. So, you know, there's that. Let me now post the link to that. If you want to buy it for yourself. I don't know. The shipping is kind of ridiculous from online retailers and shit like that, but I wanted to try somewhere else. I've tried Craft Shack before. They're not bad for the shipping, but you do have to make a sizable purchase, which I did. Anyway. The crack sounded refreshing. It did, didn't it? Let's take a sip of this, too. I haven't tried it yet. Smell? Smells very hazy IPA. Yeah, very tropical fruit forward. I would definitely say the aftertaste is very lemony. But that's from the hops. I don't know which hops exactly are in here. I'm sure if there's another site that tells you what ones are. My guess would be like Citra and Mosaic and maybe another New Zealand-styled hop, because those usually have those kind of tastes. Anyway, let's get the screen up here. I'm going to mute this too because it will double play audio if I don't. Got a little things to go through before we wait for Porky. Since I had that prepared, because I knew we probably would have to wait for him. Let me get the capture up. There it is. Boop, boop. OBS is now connecting. Yeah, I guess I taste the rambutan. If you've ever had lychee, it's a lot like that. They're in the same family of plants. So sour, sorry, soapsop, which is, I just forgot the name of the fruit. And I know that, I mean, the name really is soapsop, but, or soapberry, that is ackee. It's ackee fruit. That's right. All right, let's watch this. to review Phantasmagoria.
Warning! The following video contains gore, sexual violence, minor spoilers, and atrociously bad acting. Okay. Viewer discretion is advised.
This one's a channel pushing up roses. She's a game reviewer.
Hey everyone, Pushing Up Roses here, and welcome to Phantasmagoria.
Not a puzzle of flesh.
Phantasmagoria is a point-and-click adventure game featuring full-motion video developed by Sierra and released in 1995.
Yes,
it's known for its adult content, including sexual violence and gore, and has a pretty big cult following at this point. Personally, the game isn't on my list of favorites. It has a lot of bad points and some good points, both of which I'll touch on, but mostly I'm just going to make fun of it because this game is perfect riffing fodder.
I could use some drain cleaner.
You're greeted with an amazingly cheesy introduction with such horrific imagery as snakes with human heads, various torture devices, and friggin' curtains. Oh my god, freaky. By the way, the intro song for this game is epic. It was written by Mark Siebert. Yes, the same person who wrote this.
Oh god, it's King's Quest. Oh my god.
Also wrote this. Adrienne Delaney, a somewhat well-known novelist, wakes up from a nightmare and is immediately comforted by her husband, Don.
I'll always be here to protect you.
Hey, Don, best character in the whole series. By series, I mean one game.
Oh, God.
Besides Curtis, but that's a second game that's not related at all.
Oh, God, stop. Stop!
Ew,
this is worse than the upcoming gore. They just moved into this huge mansion, previously owned by a notorious illusionist named Zoltan Karnovash. Karno's wives are rumored to have been murdered by him, whom at the time was allegedly possessed by an evil demon.
You know, as you do.
Hmm. Evil demon is kind of redundant. I guess you're inherently evil if you're a demon. While exploring her new home, Adrienne finds a hidden chapel containing a mysterious-looking box, in which she haphazardly opens and releases the previously mentioned evil demon.
It was a product of its time.
Or just demon, rather.
We watched it.
Ow, it farted right in my eye. The demon heads right for Don, possessing him and also haunting the rest of the estate.
Yep.
You play as Adrienne, whom, in my opinion, is the worst, most poorly written female protagonist ever.
She is.
Seriously, it is all Adrienne's fault that this evil was released.
Yes, it is.
And if you don't think she's the worst protagonist after watching this, I think we can all at least agree that she is the worst dressed. Oh yes, here's Adrienne being sexy in her tight orange sweater tucked into her black kinky mom jeans. I love pants with an elastic waistband. Ooh, ah. As a character, Adrienne is stiff, boring, poorly acted.
Excuse me, miss, not all dainty.
Yay, it worked.
Yay. And for a writer, is incredibly short-sighted. Despite the mansion becoming increasingly scary with more instances of haunting and Don's obvious change in character, she insists that she doesn't believe in ghosts.
Watched it.
You know, people act very strange when I tell them I bought the Karnovash estate.
Well, why do you think that is?
It's rumored to be haunted.
Also, why does that look like
her mom? Do you believe in ghosts?
Awkward pause? No, I guess not. Wow. We missed this.
Of course not.
Yeah, okay, so I suppose you just ignored this weird apparition in the nursery, the blatant warnings on your laptop, and the weird visions of Karno's murders.
Actually, Cindy, you missed the death thrill at the end, because you have to be... She died a lot.
Dude,
her face got
Karno even comes to you during a seance in the form of phlegmy green boogers to try to warn you. That is some serious shit. Not to mention the fact that Don has started acting like a complete dick.
Yes, he has.
Don't be coy with me. I asked you several times to go buy me drain cleaner. Now, did you do it?
Okay, calm your ass down, second-rate Val Kilmer. We'll get those pipes unclogged. By the way, the warnings that Adrienne comes across during the game are being left by the ghosts of Karno's previous wives, all murdered by him in really gruesome ways. I guess they want to help Adrienne so she can start planning her escape and getting the hell out of there, but Adrienne doesn't believe in ghosts.
Of course not.
Meanwhile, Don has gone completely crackers due to his demonic possession.
He starts laughing like a joker. inappropriate.
This game is supposed to be dark and scary and really tap into a different tone than the previous Roberta Williams games. But I don't understand how I can possibly be scared of this guy. He is practically devouring the scenery.
Yes,
we also have Harriet, a homeless person dressed like a garden gnome who's been camping out in the estate's barn with Cyrus, her brawny, but not brainy son.
Name's Harriet.
Looks like Josh.
Harriet Hockaday. Blows my son Cyrus.
Huh? Oh, yeah.
She's a pretty stark contrast to anything dark and brooding, and sometimes unintentionally serves as the game's comic relief.
Oh, come on, you gotta help Mom!
Help! Help me!
Oh, God.
Gotta love those community theater volunteers.
One thing
that makes up for this lack of acting skill is the inclusion of Douglas Seal, a classically trained British actor whom you may recognize as the Sultan from Aladdin. He plays a character named Malcolm Wormshadow. Yes, Wormshadow. And
Malcolm
he lived at the Carno estate when he was young, so he's good for extra insight and story.
That guy was the Sultan from Aladdin? The voice of him? Holy shit. I didn't know that.
It's back.
Jafar? The gameplay can be accurately described as a sitting simulator.
Cool.
Man, you can sit on so many things, and you can poke the fireplace for a few minutes, and just look at this riveting action sequence where Adrian takes 500 years to knock out a panel. Yes, hello, Red Baron Pizza. I'd like to place an order for a deep dish. 45-minute wait? Let me check something real quick.
Yes.
Yeah, I got time. The puzzle design is admittedly better than the other Roberta Williams games with their moon logic and unwinnable situations. As far as I know, you can't get yourself in an unwinnable, and there's always a way to find what you need to complete the game.
Porky.
But the inventory puzzles themselves are kind of...
This chick is pushing up roses. She's got tattoos near her titties. So that's fun.
Okay.
Let's get you on screen and put the logo on you.
Oh.
Boop. Yes.
Do you have my new...
No, I do not have your new avatar yet, Porky.
Okay.
We will, I think we'll do that next time.
What?
Well, it'll be Halloween season by then, so you can dress up.
No, Halloween is all fall.
I understand. It's a way of life.
Don't you forget what
we're doing. We are doing stuff for it. I understand. But we'll be in full costume. Or I'll shed my human skin so I won't look the way I do on screen now. And you'll be in a spooky, spooky costume.
Simple, to a fault. Or they're just stupid. For example, did you know that you can dismantle a brick wall entirely with just a letter opener?
Yeah, that did happen in the game.
There's also a lot of unnecessarily long action sequences that don't do anything at all, and they're always followed by silence since Adrian doesn't talk that much. It's all very... quiet. Let us now discuss the more controversial topics surrounding this game, because I know that's why you're all here. It's a very well-known fact that this game has gore and sexual violence, and it garnered a lot of press back in the day. The gore is cheesy and not very well executed. It is a little nausea-inducing, I suppose, but some of these scenes are really forced, and I feel the same way about the rape scene, which kind of came out of nowhere.
Don,
while possessed by Carno, gets extremely violent while engaging in sexual intercourse, despite there being zero accounts of sexual assault in Carno's history. It's really supposed to be more hard-hitting and evoke some kind of emotion. I mean, even Adrian, who is usually flat as a board throughout the entire game, is crying and expressing trauma, but I can still tell it was shoehorned in just for the sake of being shocking. Otherwise, it adds basically nothing to the story. Consider 1995. Sierra was about to slowly start fading out, and I think Roberta and the company felt like they had to do something to get people talking. Doom and Mortal Kombat had found success with their adult content, and Roberta even mentions those games in an interview. So I'm wondering if Sierra felt the need to catch up, per se, to stay relevant in a rapidly changing market, and what better way to get people talking than to shock them with cheap exploits. Don't get me wrong here, there are games that have really executed darker subject matter without being lazy or comical. Like Night Trap!
Just plain.
A good example is I Have No Mouth and I Must Scream, which features a scene that was so evocative, it literally made the hair on the back of my neck rise. I just can't take this seriously, and the bad acting only makes it worse. What is this face even? Is he constipated? Some would argue that the nature of the game is very akin to B-rated horror movies, and there's definitely some merit to that. Thing is, this game seems like it's having a major identity crisis.
It is.
It's a little B-movie, it's a little thriller, and it's a little unintentionally comedic. Maybe the darker elements would have shown through better if this game didn't constantly teeter on corny. The controversy and adult content worked in Sierra's favor. It was one of the best-selling games of 1995, and up to that point, it was Sierra's best-selling game. So they knew what they were doing, but hear you me, people did not buy this game because it was good.
Regardless.
People bought it because side boob. Yep. People knew it would have some shock value, and thus, sales. But not everything is bad or corny or cheesy. There's some legitimately creepy moments in this game, and you get an eerie feeling while exploring the mansion. The music adds to this, and I actually think the ending of this game is extremely good. Shit really hits the fan at the end while you're trying to escape from possessed Val Kilmer, and suddenly there's a lot of action and suspense, and I was really on the edge of my seat trying to figure it all out. Even the special effects for the death scenes at the end of the game, created by the character shop, were pretty impressive, much more so than the previous murder scenes. The live action, coordinated with animated sequences, and the compositing it took to match the backgrounds with the actors were huge amounts of work. The whole game was acted in front of a blue screen, and the entire design was incredibly complex, and it truly was a technical challenge for Williams. It was budgeted to cost around $800,000, but ended up costing about $4.5 million. It grossed around $12 million in sales. So yeah, I can see why Roberta claims this is the project she is most proud of. I don't agree, not even a little bit. I do not think this is her best game, but I think it is the game she put the most amount of work into.
Probably.
So when I think about it that way, I can understand her sentiments. Sometimes the tech in this game really looks good, and I appreciate it, and I can see all the hard work that went into it. And sometimes I can see the artifacting around the characters' bodies
like
from the blue screen
like
blatantly breaking the suspension of
it
disbelief.
Did.
Uniquely designed work doesn't guarantee that it will be good or even be liked.
Yeah.
Just look at James Cameron's Avatar. Technically and visually sound, but overall,
but
people found it uninspired.
Avatar,
in conclusion, I don't hate this game. I actually always have fun revisiting it, even though I can't take it seriously the way I think it was meant to be. At the very least, it's insanely fun to riff on, and like I said, I genuinely enjoyed the last chapter when things got a little bit more frantic. When this title comes up within my group of adventure game buddies, we always joke and snark about it. It definitely has its place in PC gaming, and there's a lot of discussion to have come out of this release. And now that it's on GOG.com, it's much easier to run and play on modern systems. So give it a shot, especially if you like blood that resembles ketchup and really awkwardly performed conversations.
And there's discs.
Come on, Don. Here's the drain cleaner you requested. Jeez.
Yeah. Thanks.
Yeah. Awkward pause.
Hey everyone, thanks for watching my video on Phantasmagoria.
Okay, moving on from Retroware TV and subscribe. There you go. That was Pushing Up Roses. Now we got this dude. DefunctGames.com. This was made in 2013.
Corpse Killer is far from a great game.
Look at that.
But I was won over by the cheesy, B-rate video and the engaging, albeit ridiculous, plot. Even when the action isn't great, this full-motion video game knows how to keep things moving.
It's probably the more
I gave it a C. But you don't care what I have to say. You're here to find out what the critics at Electronic Gaming Monthly, GamePro, and all of the classic magazines said at the time. Let's start this look back with Next Generation Magazine, which absolutely hated this game. The nameless writer only gave this game 1 out of 5 stars, complaining that Corpse Killer was a decent shooter with some great footage and some extremely repetitive shooting. Yeah, that sounds about right. GamePro was a little more forgiving. Game Over Man scored the game a 3.5 out of 5, enjoying much of the goofiness Corpse Killer has to offer. He noted that hardcore shoot-'em-up vets may get a kick out of it, but fans of drive-in horror movies may have mixed feelings. His review was appallingly non-committal. Over at Electronic Gaming Monthly, Sushi X gave the game a 5 out of 10. He noted early on that he isn't a big fan of the full-motion video game genre, and that it always feels like they leave too much out. At one point he asks you to call him impatient, and then argues that he needs more than just eye candy. He's not wrong. Also at EGM, Ed Semrad agrees that you absolutely must like B-rate horror movies to have a good time with Corpse Killer. He wasn't as thrilled with the mindless shooting, calling the game okay, but not great. After pulling the scores from all of the different classic magazines and averaging them together, Corpse Killer scores 50%. That's exactly what I gave it at Defunct Games. Read this review and others at defunctgames.com, and don't forget to hit the subscribe button.
No, I'm not going.
What do you say to that?
Look at that quality! Oh my god! Oh, that movie maker shit is so good. So Porky, yesterday we watched a movie you like called Zero or X-Row, right?
Yeah.
We watched that. Here's Siskel and Ebert talking about it, so you know they're gonna be stuck up pieces.
They are gonna love it so much.
Yes, they are.
They're gonna give it like 10 out of 10.
Oh yeah, clearly. Why wouldn't they? Also, if we hear, I see a heads up copyright notice, I'm gonna fucking laugh because they're long dead. Who gives a shit? James Bond music. Octopussy? What? Are they reviewing two?
Bad. Let's hear
if they say they love it, because I'll laugh.
Maybe they just mention it, like, in the Octopussy review.
Maybe, we'll see. I put this...
Just another day at the office for Roger Moore, Special Agent 007. In Octopussy, the 13th James Bond adventure, one of five new films.
Yeah, they wouldn't start with X-Row.
At the movies.
No.
And across the aisle from me is Gene Siskel, film critic of the Chicago Tribune.
And this is Roger Ebert, film critic of the Chicago Sun-Times. Now, in addition to the James Bond film, we'll also be reviewing Robert Duvall's film about American gypsies called Angelo, My Love. Also, Joseph Losey's French film, The Trout, that condemns the rich. And a documentary film called Hollywood Outtakes with some surprising footage of some famous Hollywood stars appearing outside their regular movie roles. But first, Roger begins with...
Yeah, here we go.
X-Tro, that's X-T-R-O.
Remember that spelling? Remember that name? Our first movie is one of the most mean-spirited and ugly thrillers I've seen in a long time. It's called X-Tro.
Mean-spirited.
This movie made me feel awful inside. What a pussy. Oh, it's mean-spirited. This mean movie. What a piece of shit.
Oh, gosh.
All right, let's keep going.
It's a monster movie, and it's not a very good monster movie, but that's okay because most monster movies aren't very good.
Oh, man. Man, he should do stand up.
Yeah.
Most, like, what the fuck? I wonder what monster movies he does like. They're probably super gay.
Oh, they're probably those stupid art housey ones that no one likes. Those ones that it's like, oh, actually, I think they liked some movie where it was all in trim. Like, oh, fuck off. Fuck off. Yeah, your film school shit is showing. Roger Ebert. You fucking talentless heck.
A lot of them, though, do somehow manage to be entertaining in a dumb, goofy, stupid sort of way just by...
What? I think we missed something there.
He said there are monster movies that had to be entertaining in a dumb, goofy, stupid sort of way.
Oh, so he just likes... Yeah. That's what he likes.
Yes, he likes movies that would probably be... I don't know. That's the thing with people like him and fucking Siskel. They're, like, so snooty that the only shit they like is stuff that people don't like. Like, I mean, I get it. I get the whole fact that critics have to see a lot of movies. Like, a lot of movies, right? But you and I watch a lot of movies. Everybody does.
I wonder if Neo Jesus is related to these guys.
It would be hilarious.
It's like his uncle on his mom's side or something.
Yeah, his
or his great uncle.
Yeah, his great uncle's fucking Roger Ebert. pretentious fucking film school shit. I don't get it. I mean, I kind of, it's hard to put to words. Like, I get film critics become jaded and all this other shit. Fuck off. Fuck off with your highbrow falutin shit. That's not why movies were made. The movies were made to be entertaining. Does it entertain me? Then fuck off. I don't need a deeper meaning to it. It's supposed to be entertaining.
By giving us such ridiculous monsters, Extro doesn't even try. Here's a scene where a spaceship lands.
Extro doesn't even try, Porky. It doesn't even try to be entertaining at all. It doesn't try to be a monster movie at all. Could you imagine being this motherfucker here and wait till the internet comes around where everyone thinks that Skinwalker shit is real in this movie? That's still... I didn't try at all.
I mean, it's not even really monster as much as just, like, extraterrestrial.
Yeah, it is. It's just a fucking alien. It's creepy. There's creepy parts of it. I don't know what you're saying, like, oh, it doesn't even try. That's not true. The effects are actually really good.
Yeah.
Here we go. Let's see some footage. Let's, like, judge it.
Yeah, that part was actually really cool.
No, both Gene Siskel and Roger Ebert are long dead. They both died of cancer. Siskel had like a tumor in his throat, and Roger Ebert also had a tumor in his throat, but he got it removed.
But then succumbed to like
something bad. I don't remember what kind it was. But yes, that's how they both died.
Did you ever stop to ask yourself how a civilization develops enough intelligence to come all the way to Earth from another star, and then they don't have enough sense to not stand in the middle of the road when a car is coming along? The movie never bothers to explain much of anything about these monsters. They land.
Doesn't that make it more creepy, though, that they don't explain shit?
Yeah.
I think to me that makes it more disturbing.
And they take over a little boy's father. The little boy has nightmares. He has a pet snake named Harry. His daddy comes back and eats Harry's eggs and so forth.
Eats one egg. He doesn't eat all of them.
And completely cheerless exercise that leads to an utterly hopeless conclusion. You'd either go to a monster movie because it was good or maybe...
Oh, no, Neo Jesus? Yeah, Neo Jesus is still alive.
Extro doesn't even qualify as acceptable trash.
Absolutely.
Whoa! Not even acceptable trash. Woo! Man, I love watching how fucking wrong critics can be. And this is the biggest people you can see of how wrong critics are. These two. One of the, two of the most famous critics in films.
This is like what Film Review was back when, like, we had the legacy media.
Yes.
When everybody watched the same news, and then everybody got the same fucking opinion about movies. That's what this was.
Yeah, and the people that came along to basically give a different opinion about stuff was people like Joe Bob Briggs, who gave you, like, he liked that shit. He made fun of people like them because they were idiots. Too bad that Joe Bob has turned himself into kind of a dummy more recently, as we know. But that just happens. Time is not kind to anybody. You live long enough to see yourself become the people you do not like. Anyway.
Sitting here trying to figure out now which was the
but
most
again, he does have people he answers
picture.
To, so that
the one
could be
where the father
I'm not sure.
Yeah.
Snake eggs.
Yeah, well, he has changed his views a lot, though, unfortunately.
I'd have to say where you see the birth of a man out of a woman's womb.
But that
a full-grown man. That's really a nice scene.
That is a fun scene.
It's a great scene. It's one of the fucking best in the movie. I don't know what you're talking about, Siskel. It's fucking fantastic. It's great. Rips their guts out and starts eating them, too. It's great.
Born on screen with all this garbage all
I don't think I'd enjoy it very much. The disgusting thing about this film, though, is that it doesn't even have the courage to admit what it is, which is entertaining matinee trash, and let's have a little fun. Instead, the conclusion is so nihilistic.
It's so nihilistic? It's a sequel bait. The end's a sequel bait. Doofus.
I don't know. I mean, in a way, you understand, like, the aliens don't have, like, a moral...
No, they don't.
...compass like we do.
No, they do
but
not.
But in many ways, like, the way that the father is, like, trying to be with his son, it's like they have their special bond.
Yes.
Which is, like, a good bond.
Yes.
Like, their means are terrible, but, like, the idea is that he's come here to take his son with him, and they're going to live and be aliens wherever the aliens are.
Yes.
You know what I mean?
Yes, because he had to change his son to be that, too.
I mean, I guess, it is kind of weird that they could have changed it, and they could have had the mom becoming an alien, too.
Yeah, so the whole family was reunited again. That would.
But no, the mom stayed.
Yep, and she gets to find the eggs and then die that way.
Yeah.
But then again, that's, again, sequel bait, because there were two more movies after this, so...
So they must have made money.
They made something. They still bombed. They didn't make the whole thing, but...
I think the first one was the only one that was, like, in any kind of theater-like thing.
Yeah, it was. It made any kind of impact, because the fucking... That one scene, Skinwalker shit, and the, you know, the birth scene and stuff like that. Definitely very inspired by the original Alien. I don't know, was Aliens out at that time, too? Maybe? I'm not sure if it was.
Alien came out in, like, 79, I think.
Did it? Oh, yeah, that's right. Alien. No, I mean Aliens.
Aliens, yeah. 80s? Aliens didn't come out until, like, mid-80s, mid-late 80s.
Yeah, let me see.
It was a sequel that came out much later.
Yeah, let's see.
Like, 87. I'm going to go with 87, because all the best movies came out when I was born. It's not a coincidence.
That doesn't sound egotistical at all.
It's not a coincidence.
No, totally. Let's see. I think it is 87, I think you're right. Or Extro is 1986. So Extro came out in...
82, or 83.
Yeah, 82. So it was not inspired by Aliens, but the original Alien. That's where you have the whole, like, scene where he's putting that fucking suction cup on her face and all that. It's supposed to be like a sugar. There's a lot of inspiration. I mean, a lot of stuff, regardless, took inspiration from Alien. It was very cinematic and very groundbreaking when it came out. Which, you know, of course, they probably fucking loved because of everything else that happened with that movie, but heaven forbid Extro have something similar to Aliens with the body horror shit. No. Not the same. Awful.
Nihilistic. Fuck them. The movie basically says, that's it, everybody's gonna die, there's no hope, fade to black.
Well, no, the father and the son, they went back to be aliens.
Yeah, they did.
They didn't die.
Philosophical statement out of this garbage. It was offensive.
Garbage is the operative word. Coming up.
Do you really need to take a philosophical statement out of a movie? I don't think you do. I think you can just enjoy it. I think you can just enjoy it.
Next at the movies, the latest James Bond film starring Roger Moore.
Oh, hey, Ramen. Oh, the old book that said video games can't be art. That's true, he did say that, I think.
We open your eyes to great entertainment. Now, we're gonna open your ears to stereo sound.
Oh boy. Is this fuck, is that Laserdisc?
Stereo video disc player, letting you enjoy great stereo entertainment.
Yes, it is.
Sweet.
Woo!
Basic players start at $2.99 stereo.
That shit still.
$2.99 and $83.
Yeah, oh fuck.
That's expensive.
It is. But it's worth it. Laserdisc was 100% worth it.
Yeah.
And the quality is literally
DVD
close to
quality, basically, in the 80s.
Yeah. Biohazard time, Porky. Let's watch Dark Corners talk about it.
The greatest scientific
this
discovery
movie.
In history.
I mean, the limitation of Laserdisc was the two television.
Yes.
Welcome back to
television.
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 It's only a movie. It's only a movie.
Chosen by one of our Patreon shadows.
Patreon.
Please sign up if you'd like to pick a film for us to review. Biohazard is the work of unapologetically trashy filmmaker
fucking, the
Fred
thing shirt.
Olin Ray.
Woo!
And like The Alien Dead, which we reviewed last year, this is a throwback to those Alien on the Rampage in a small town movies of the 50s.
Yes, it is.
We're definitely dealing with some.
That's why everything
acts so
stilted.
Life. But with a few twists along the way.
This device makes it possible to amplify Lisa's brainwaves as she attempts to channel them.
She had nice titties.
Psychic Lisa Martin has hooked up with scientist Dr.
A little bit
Williams,
of an older lady.
Who is able to utilize her unique attributes.
With the help of Miss Martin and the equipment you see here, I am able to reassemble matter, physical
material. I'd say she looks older than 35.
From an unknown dimension.
Put bluntly.
You mean you can reach into another world, grasp an object,
look at
and
that
bring
shot.
It back here to
classic
this lab?
Classic Fred Olin Ray 50
which
shot right
Which they are now
there.
Demonstrating to the usual military types.
Afternoon, General.
All squeeze in. The camera won't go back any further.
Yeah.
The experiment doesn't go perfectly as Williams fries his assistant.
Yes, he does. That was good. That scene was fun.
Yeah.
But I guess that doesn't have any effect as it's never mentioned again.
Nope.
And Lisa's mind has successfully drawn matter from another dimension.
I wonder what this is. It looks like a container of some sort.
Specifically, a china figure and a metal crate.
You know, as you
do. Looks like an average episode of Bargain Hunt. Like the fried assistant, the figurine is never mentioned
again.
Well,
at least all horror movies.
The metal crate is loaded onto a van with a sentry standing guard.
Actually, I can't tell this, actually. I don't think that's British.
Another
look at that child.
Porky
a child.
That because she
it's like
it
a 10-year-old child. It's
Lisa
amazing.
Lisa retains some
gotta
sort
be a relative
of psychic
I like to imagine it just like a regular kid just like running around like, just playing pretend.
Are you sure
pretend?
That's not coming from the guy who got his face ripped off?
And this is the whole movie's
seems
in his
so
brain.
Seems senseless to kill it.
And so we're into that classic trope of army versus science coming together symbolically in the lead couple.
What would you like to do until 11 o'clock?
Read my mind.
Not often you see that sort of age
oh my
gap
God.
When the woman is the older one.
Neo Does Jesus put up a fucking James Rolfe Times Forgotten filmmaker. What the fuck? Oh, we'll have to watch that next time, Porky.
It's for you.
Titties.
Before they can go any further, they are interrupted by a phone call.
I measured it when I got off duty. It was 13 inches. I just checked it and it's 14.
Did you just call to brag?
Look, don't touch that thing.
Booty.
Who knows what might happen? Earlier,
but he did
Mike
but he did
stole
touch it, though.
A mysterious item that he found in the crate. Is everyone else seeing a cardboard box covered in tape?
Yep.
Again, Lisa has insight.
It's not growing. It's opening itself.
Well, I guess you either call a scientist to examine it.
No.
No.
Or the army to contain it.
Okay, now I'm
like
going to try to hammer
band?
It back to
I don't
size.
Know who that was.
Yep, that's the sensible third option.
Maybe.
No, that's the end you hold. You hit it with the other ends of the hammer.
Oh,
nah,
no.
Nah.
I've made things much worse.
Every time, I can't stand
Although
it.
This is not the plot
Why
to Alien,
like
the
that?
Creature
does it,
certainly
does it hurt your
is
mechanic
alien
soul, Porky?
From Facehugger.
That thing...
To
Puppy.
Adult.
It was adorable.
Incidentally, the adult alien is played by Ray's 7-year-old son.
Seven. Amazing.
The 7-year-old?
And as long as we're talking about casting,
I knew he looked
played
tiny.
By Angelique Pettyjohn, famed for her appearance in Star Trek.
Oh. Oh, that's who she is. Is the chick
Slow
getting her
down.
Punches.
How many times
oh, this lady.
A pickle. Your pickle head.
And nagging wife oh. Ruler is played by Carol Borland.
You're just a dumb old
forever
pickle
iconic for her role in Mark of the Vampire.
Oh.
It's
okay.
Ruler and her husband Jack who next run into the creature.
They hit a 7-year-old child.
Literally.
Playing in the
and
road.
Jack sees dollar signs.
I got me a monster. One.
Look, that
doesn't
kid was having
well
a great
Jack.
Time till those old people
came. Oh, yeah. Oh. You know what? That makes the movie so much
Although,
better.
I'd say the sheriff
the 7-year-old
is just knowing this little kid
blame.
Is just having a blast running around
yes,
with a costume.
They 100% are.
You're right
hitting
down
people
there.
And stuff.
Mm-hmm.
The alien continues.
Ah!
That bumped this movie up
some...
like 10 points for me.
It did.
Dribbling on others.
Drool.
Until...
See, that's why nobody's taken when they get killed.
True.
Because normally you
when
have a couple naked kills
the alien
in movies
dead,
like this.
I thought it
you
was
would.
Pretty obviously a spoof.
Oh, the
this
E.T. thing where it gets ripped.
This is a lot less clear cut. Partly because, at times, it is obviously tongue-in-cheek. Most notably when the alien encounters an E.T. poster.
Fuck you, E.T. Aliens are supposed to be mean.
Others, definitely not.
I'm pretty sure he's dead. I don't think he ever gets back up.
The problem is that the dialogue is so bad.
It is.
This
so stilted.
So utterly removed from anything a person would actually say.
It's like something
the most
a robot
incredible
would say.
Thing I've ever seen in my life.
Yes, I think we've seen history here today.
Almost a spiritual experience.
But it's hard to believe it was ever intended to be taken seriously.
I'll admit it does sound rather far-fetched.
The guy chewing
on the
in
other
the background.
Hand, not for money at all.
Ah!
Or at least not intentionally. At least I don't think.
That's for you to think.
You also have to factor in the ending.
The creature
which is an alien
soldier designed to fight our wars.
And, oh, then,
as it emerges that Lisa is not just on the alien's side,
but one
but,
of them. Not her titties, no.
No.
thought they were real.
Thank God that phone call came when it did earlier.
Yeah. I'll get rid of them.
And then...
This can't be real. I think that's it.
Yeah, I think that's how it ends.
This is ridiculous.
And that is the problem with Biohazard. It sure as hell isn't serious.
Nope.
But it sure as hell isn't funny. Particularly not during the long minutes of outtakes under the credits, mm-hmm. which are just awkward.
You know, the real trick to my culinary activity is to, that oh, I've no. acquired, you know,
man.
The real activity.
Oh,
you know,
yeah,
the real
that poor guy.
You know, the real trick to my culinary ability to...
Brent has to know him,
you know,
I'm
the
sure,
real
but still.
Trick, you know, the real trick to my...
I felt more sympathy for him than any character in the film.
Yeah.
You're right. You're right again.
Thanks for watching. See all of our Alien movie reviews here. Nice to see Angelique Pettyjohn and Carol Borland. What other cult bit...
All right, we're going to pause him because, Porky, it is time. It is time we review a movie together called Evil Toons. It was so bad, wasn't it, Porky?
Yeah.
It was really shitty. And I knew it was going to be. It was a Fred Olin Ray movie from his later period, so I knew it was going to be trash.
The final girl,
mm-hmm.
We just in Red Letter Media, they reviewed another movie with her.
Okay.
She's in Deathstalker 2.
Oh, nice.
And she's famous for thinking that acting just means moving your eyebrows when you talk. That's her. She's that person from Deathstalker. Every time she says something, her eyes get big or small.
Mm-hmm.
And then they just reviewed Silk 2.
Oh, boy.
Where she has, like, a whole fight scene in the movie, like, topless.
Oh,
where
boy.
She gets, like, attacked in the
she
night.
She has some nice titties, though.
Oh, my gosh, yeah. And also, she's the only woman in the movie who didn't do porn.
Yeah, the other people did porn. That's why.
And actually, it's funny, because I mentioned Michelle Bauer before.
Yes.
And there's, like, a 2-minute scene in this movie where Michelle Bauer is Dick, what's his name?
Yes, Dick Miller's wife.
Dick Miller's like wife that he's not interested in.
Yes, he's not. He has to go do things. He's busy.
And it's like,
so she takes
Michelle
up like
Bauer's
a fucking...
the prettiest girl in the movie.
She is. Like, she 100% is
next
the prettiest
next
girl.
Next to Gabriel.
Gabriella, yeah.
Monique Gabriel.
Yes,
that's
the chick with the big titties.
Yeah.
So. So there's two famous people in this movie. I mean, the women are famous too, besides the porn ones. Michelle Bauer definitely is.
Well, I think the Archie guy is also kind of famous, but I don't think he's famous from anything that we know.
Like... No, he's not. But the biggest thing is David Carradine's in this fucking movie, and I found it really poignant that he fucking dies by hanging himself, since the way he actually did die was autoerotic asphyxiation.
And he's also top billed.
Yes, he is.
Even though he's only in the movie.
Briefly, at brief parts.
Very briefly.
Yeah. He's the guy that brings that book to the fucking United States after stealing it from some shithole in the UK and Britain or somewhere. Because it's like, it's an ancient book that has pretty much demons in it, but they're like doodles. They're all like doodles of demons. Like someone's real, like Fred Olin Ray just drew them. The intro actually is really nice. I liked the demons and the music for that. Man, a lot of these chicks are really trashy. They're really, really trashy.
Yeah, the other two blondes. I didn't mind the brunette.
The brunette was
alright.
She
was fun.
Yeah, she was fun.
Had to do some research.
Oh, yeah.
What's there, yeah.
Yeah, some research.
It's not that hard to find, guys.
Yeah, no, it's not. Definitely a big titty redhead chick is definitely a seller in the movie.
Yeah.
I found out that you know, that song that plays on the radio is done by a guy that's done, like, a lot of music for other movies, too. His name's, like, John Travis or something like that.
Huh.
John Travis. I could not find that song. I liked how it sounded. I thought that was a really good-sounding song. But nope, it's not in the actual soundtrack of the movie, which is on YouTube, too. So there's that. Dick Miller happens to be my favorite character, like, male character in the movie. I liked him a lot, just being usual Dick Miller.
Yeah.
I love the fact that
Dick
he
Miller
literally...
getting his dick bit off.
Yeah, he did get his dick bit off. I love the fact though he's like at home watching one of his own scenes, and then said, "This guy didn't. Why didn't this guy ever get nominated for an Emmy?" When he's watching literally himself. Ugh, Dick's been so much shit.
There's a lot of like really stupid jokes like that.
There are. There are 100%
honest,
really
and
dumb
honest
jokes.
To God, I just finished watching it. That's why I was late.
Mm-hmm.
No memorable jokes.
No, there's not.
Thing.
There's not. That tune that
there's
tries
like
to be
some...
funny at points is not funny.
There's a lot of like real lesbian kind of stuff.
Yes.
Like the brunette's like really crazy, and then she starts dancing and like taking her clothes off,
mm-hmm.
and then like the other girls are there, and they're like, "Oh, yeah."
Yeah.
And then they're like trying to get the other girl to take her clothes off.
Remember the fucking fact that like those weird sound effects, like those stock sound effects, play when she's taking her clothes off too, like the wiggle
yeah.
noises and the whoosh and all that other shit. That was great. That was great because it's trash. It's
the,
not good.
Yeah.
It's
the
bad.
Cartoon
a...
was when the actual cartoon monster is on screen.
Mm.
That's probably the worst parts of the whole movie.
Oh yeah, 100%.
So
is.
Bad.
He was so badly
drawn. I don't understand.
Drawn.
It's supposed to be like an ancient like
demon,
Evil Dead book.
Yes, because it's got the face of it that talks.
And then like a shitty like 80s cartoon pops out of it.
Yes, it does.
And
a werewolf
why?
Thing. Yeah.
Why?
It was not good. It is a bad
it's
movie.
It's not even written like a cartoon.
Nope.
When it's in the book.
Nope.
It's written like all classical, but then when it comes out of the book, it's like fucking Roger Rabbit.
Yes, it is. It's Roger
it's
Rabbit
so,
style of
it's
shit.
It's so like it's not even. It's just off-putting.
Yes, it is. I agree. This was not a good film. It was really bad. Guess what we're gonna do though, Porky? Once we finish talking about it, and you know, obviously giving a review, we're gonna watch Fred explain his whole movie process of making it. Because I found that.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. It's on YouTube, so that'll be fun. What would you say is your favorite scene from the movie?
That's tough.
Yeah, because there's not much. I know.
Honest to God, I mean, the whole movie's trash. Probably
yes.
when that brunette is doing a little strip thing, or when
mm-hmm.
Monique Gabriel is standing in the mirror touching herself.
Oh, yeah, that was pretty good, too.
For, like, no real reason? Just
no, she's
doing
just,
it.
Like, looking at her titties.
She's staring, like, she got embarrassed downstairs because they were, like, trying to get her to take her clothes off, and then she goes upstairs, and she's, like,
feeling
like,
up
touching
her
nipples
yep.
and stuff, and, like, making weird faces.
Yeah.
It's so weird.
It is. It's like she has to put self-confidence in, like,
oh,
hey,
actually,
I do have big titties.
At the end, the whole movie, she didn't seem to do the eyebrow stuff too much, but
no,
it was hard to tell because she's got, like, the nerd thing going on
yes.
where she wears her hair kind of down and she wears the big glasses.
Yes.
But... once she was talking to David Carradine in the end, she could not help herself. Even with the glasses, you could see her eyebrows moving up and down. It was pretty
yeah,
funny.
You could. My favorite scene, besides like the you know the obviously sex-selling scenes where they tried to really sell characters of being sexy and everything else, would happen to be the end of the movie when he brings over the portable fucking TV and says, "Don't you kids like Saturday morning cartoons?"
Yeah. And then she looks at the screen and screams.
Yeah, and then
that's
there's
two
the fucking...
Fred Olin Ray movies where it ends with like
screams.
The fourth wall break.
Mm-hmm. Because you literally see after that like the scene that comes up like it's technically the credits roll, but you see him like back away to
yeah.
like leave after he had come with the TV. So that's funny. Yeah, it was not good. This is a bad movie. It's not very redeemable.
It's
not even entertaining for a Fred Olin Ray movie.
It was just. This was the time in his career where he seemed to know a lot of porn stars, and
yeah.
they're like, hey, we can make some rated R stuff, and you can show your tits off, and you can make some money, you know, without having to get, like, a, you know, fucked. So, I
yeah.
guess that's what the allure for them was. Like, okay, we'll do this.
That's 100% what that was. So,
I mean, that's, yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's not like there's no real point in continuing to talk about it because what ends up happening, I mean, I'll just spoil the end. So, again, you guys don't have to watch this. I would recommend if you want to see tits, then that's the only reason to watch this or watch Dick Miller be Dick Miller. I don't know if he can save it, though, alone. He's a really fun actor, but I don't know if he can save it.
Yeah.
The way it ends is that she kills the demon and because she burns the book. She stabs the demon, then burns the book, and then they all, like, vanish. David Carradine explains to her, because the book no longer exists, he no longer exists, so everybody that was dead is now alive. And so they're all back to being alive after being killed by the demon. So
yeah,
that's...
and the final girl's the only one who remembers
yep.
any of it.
Nobody else does. They all think they had a big fucking party and got really drunk. So that's pretty much that movie summed up. Okay, Porky, what would you say your rating for is?
Like, out of 5?
Yes.
Like... like a 1.7.
Okay. I'm gonna go with that too, because I'm not gonna say like it was a 1.5. I can see it being Dick Miller gives it a 1 because he's fun. Some of the actors that are there give it kind of like a 1. David Carradine does not. He barely fucking acts in the movie. He was actually probably the worst.
He shows up in the beginning and then he
meanders in parts.
And his explanation for taking so long showing up is like really stupid. Cause
yes, it is.
The whole thing is like, as long as the demons were in the book, they couldn't be killed.
Yes.
And he was like waiting in limbo because he was attached to the book, even though he killed himself.
Yes.
And so he took the opportunity, the girls staying there, to get them to open the book. But then he waits the whole runtime of the movie, even though the demons come out of the book like almost immediately, like within the first 30 minutes.
Yes,
he waits another hour of the movie, like with like a bunch of people getting murdered before he shows up and like kills the demon, which was the whole point of him giving the book to them.
Yeah.
It's like, you could have just showed up earlier, bro.
Yeah, he 100%.
Could have like told the girls like what you did, like, hey.
Yeah, but nope, let's be mysterious, weird, and not talk.
Yeah, I got you to open this thing so that you let these demons out so that I could kill them. So now you need to help me. Like, that's how this would have happened if it had happened. But it didn't. It's poorly written. It's basically like in the end scene where the girl kills the other two blondes. The most forgettable characters.
Yes.
She's got to be on top of them and like ripping their top off. And like the whole point of the movie was for that.
Yes, it was. We forgot to mention the fact that the demon takes that one chick's form after he kills an
Easter. Yeah, the demon takes the brunette.
Yes.
And then she's got to, like, have her top off
every time
she
kills
somebody, or she's got to be taking somebody else's top off.
Because it was, I remember, too, it's the fact that the demon needed to kill someone to have mortal flesh again. That's what it was. It had to, like, shed someone's blood to basically be real, because it wasn't real. It was that toon thing. That was the explanation for that. It was a poor explanation, because, again, this movie is poorly written. But, yeah, that's our review of it. It wasn't too spectacular or anything. It was actually kind of bad. But you know, sometimes you gotta go through trash to remember the good movies that we like to watch. So with that being said, let's get the screen up and let's see Fred try to explain himself, shall we? Wrong thing. I didn't do that. I accidentally got the chat captured. So sorry everybody for that. Alright, let's Fred Olin Ray. Nope, it's paused. I don't know why it paused itself, and it skipped ahead for whatever reason. Let's go back.
Oh, and even the cartoon's got to rip her top off.
Yep.
So I'm sitting in this movie theater one day, and I'm watching Who Framed Roger Rabbit? And I see Jessica Rabbit come on, and all the guys are going, blah, 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 boom, I'd have sex with that. And I said, you know, I bet that somebody'd pay money to see a cartoon character rip a girl's clothes off. And so I came up with the idea that I would make this movie and it would be called Evil Toons. And I figured it'd be like one of those Friday the 13th movies, you know, where you go through the whole film, you just see the hand of the killer, you see his feet, the people look up. And so you don't have a lot of the killer in there, so I'd have not too much
So he's trying real hard to justify it, Porky.
And I went over to Roger Corman, and I pitched it to Roger Corman, and Roger said, Fred...
And yes, there we go, Porky, that answered your question you asked me the other day. He knows Roger quite well.
I don't think anybody could possibly do this for the kind of money you're asking for. It's just too elaborate. And I think at the time, I was asking for $250,000, $300,000, which I had earmarked $50,000 to $60,000 for the cartoon animated... live-action combo effects. And Roger didn't want to do it. He thought it was too iffy. And I went to a few other places, and it just kind of languished there, and it languished there, and it languished there. And finally, a woman named Vicky Till came to me, and she had made a movie called Millennium Countdown with Vince Van Patten and Betsy Russell. Okay. And she'd made the whole film, and then she watched it, and some people watched it, and they said, you know, Vicky, what you need in here are some topless girls. You need some nudity, and there was a fight at the end that hadn't come out quite right with a giant at Stonehenge, no less.
Okay.
And so she came, and she said, I'd like you to shoot one day.
See, this is a man who films five films in his, like,
kind of
year.
Add something to this.
Yeah. So he doesn't really always give a shit.
I need to get some nudity into this thing. So we decided we would shoot this scene at the beginning of the movie where the girls are all getting ready to go, and they're in a sorority house, and we'd interject new girls you'd never seen before.
Also,
they're all
whatever films behind him looks like real trash.
Waiting to take a shower, and Brooklyn Michelle Bauer Gorilla. Was in there. And a little girl named Shannon Wilsey, who later became a porno actress Savannah.
Oh, you don't say.
Suicide. This was one of her early things that
she committed suicide? Jesus.
And a couple other girls I don't remember. And then I had Stonehenge in the front of the house that night, the pieces they had left, and I reshot this fight. And I said to Vicky, I said, you know, I have this idea for this movie I'd like to make. It's called Evil Toons. And since you're renting all this equipment, blah, 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 we have this big house, why don't we just roll it all together and we'll make it. I'll put up some of the money, you put up some of the money, and we'll make this movie. And we got it down to where the budget was about $140,000, and we decided that we would shoot it in the same location as this Millennium Countdown thing, and we would shoot it right as soon as this finished. It would become just one long week.
That's Fred Olin
so
Ray
this
for you.
I myself in a few
shot in a week.
And I went around to my friends, Dick Miller and David Carradine, and I said, hey guys, you want to come on
He's
out?
Friends with,
this
he
movie?
Was friends with
It'll
them.
Be some
Sadly,
fun.
They're both passed.
And
he's still alive.
I had my girlfriend at the time, Suzanne Hager, in there, and I got Monique Gabrielle.
Suzanne Hager
was
your girlfriend
and
at the time?
And a girl named Madison Stone, who I'd met while working on the film Naked Obsession for Dan Golden. She was one of the dancers. And somewhere along the line,
how many people do you fucking know, Fred?
Down in Marina Del Rey, and she knew an X-rated actress named Barbara Dare, who
no,
wanted to
really.
Get into legitimate films. She was going to use her real name. Well, the name she uses in this
Brooklyn
movie
was
is Stacy Nick, but
I'm
her
sure
real name
still
is
trash.
Stacy Mitnick. And so I don't blame her for even using a different name now. But I hired some of these girls because I thought, well, I don't want to wrestle with people over the nudity. If there's a nude scene or some nudity to do, these girls
they'll
will
just get naked.
Trouble.
They'll just do
and
it. Yeah.
To that
yeah.
end,
no,
that
it makes
was
sense.
Somewhat true. But coming from a different sort of film industry, they really weren't prepared for the rigors
of 35 everybody. This is what he does.
Guild shoot that was stretched over all of 8 days. So anyway, we went into doing this. We shot at the same house that we had filmed Spirits and Inner Sanctum. The original with Tanya Roberts, and I think even Teenage Exorcist may have been shot here.
Tanya
I can't remember
Roberts.
Which one of them was actually the first one to shoot there. But it was a house down on Harvard Street, and right across the street from it's this big greenhouse that was used by Wes Craven.
She's
and
the one that was
the
married
stairs.
To him.
Oh, wow.
And so you see this house in a few, and right next door, the exterior of the house was used in Rock and Roll High School Forever. So when
huh.
I go to film this, they had painted the steps lavender. So when you see the mansion in Evil Toons, the steps have this lavender paint on it. It's left over from Rock and Roll High School Forever, or whatever the sequel was.
Oh, that's...
Made. So we start
Rock and Roll High School Forever, that's
on
the Goonies guy.
Oh, yeah.
And
with glasses,
the girls are coming and going
the that,
into
the
this
one that
house.
Got
we like the next door house because it had the big white pillar.
You know, he was in like the
but
Friday the 13th movie.
Yeah.
I
know
who
you mean, but I forget his name.
They had built up the facade, but inside it was all burned out. There was nothing in there. So we use the house next door, the Inner Sanctum.
Oh yeah, Tanya Roberts
the
is the one that's in.
So the girls are coming and going, and
Beastmaster,
I go to do
and she's
the
a Bond
interior
girl.
Of the next house, and somebody says, "Hey Fred, the house on the door on the other house is solid wood, but the inside that we're shooting over in this house, it's got an oval window in the front door." And I said, "So on the outside it has no window. When you come inside, it has one." I said, "You know, I don't know what I can do about that." I said, "Hopefully nobody will notice." And they said, "Well, you know,
hopefully no one noticed. Pray."
The door on the other side, it opens on the other.
Here's
the
thing
direction.
About Fred Olin Ray, and I'll say this too, because we covered him before. He loves fucking making movies. Look at this man.
Yeah.
He does not give a shit if it's trash. He just loves making it. He does it for the love of it. Sure, he makes money. Sure, he does a lot of shit that's probably B grade, Z grade shit. Loves making this shit always. This is not a good film. He knows it's not a good film, but he'll sell the shit out how much
he
enjoyed making it.
And it's pretty obvious he's easy with making new friends.
Yes, 100%.
And this one opens on the other one. So
this is a very kind of personal
so I took the
guy that you would see
in
like older Hollywood
down,
that would do this kind of shit.
And I changed the hinges over. So when you look
and he
at
doesn't
it,
seem like he's
the
Hollywood
the
super sleazy type.
The
I mean, he probably
part of
is sleazy. It's Fred
Olin Ray. Is that in the early going when Monique Gabrielle goes
he seems
out,
really
she's
likeable,
scared by Artie Johnson at the very beginning of the film. No. She walks out the door and the handle is on the other side and it opens out like this. She talks to Artie Johnson.
There's a reason
we've covered
him before for her to kill.
Now the door on the other side and it opens from the other side. And it's constantly going back and forth. No
so many fucking movies
said
under his belt, too.
It,
he has made
ever.
So much
no
shit.
No one's ever mentioned this to me.
Still does,
all.
But it's probably even
so
worse now.
So we went on from there, and we shot in different rooms in the basements and this sort of thing. And we had this
Bless
book created.
He likes
there were a
making
different
it
books.
I'm sure,
one that
but...
would burn and have its eyes bleed. One that talked by radio control. And one that was, what, the hero book that had the drawings and things like that in it.
The drawings
were
bad,
right?
And we
used
a Mitchell
twin-pin registered camera for the background plates. And we would shoot these background plates with our either motion or whatever that is in there, or just the background, whatever it was. And then a guy named Brett Mixon, would rotoscope these, and he would create a paper drawing
of the
chairs or the couch or even sometimes the whole girl.
Huh. Okay.
And we would then send these off to New York to a place called Streamline, and they would do a pencil test of adding the animated monster into the
Fred, it still doesn't look
and
good
the,
even
and
if it's rotoscoping.
We would
approve
it's the
pencil
test, and then they would actually ink the cells, and they would send the cell
People
back.
People tried really hard to make that look good, but
it's not good.
You know what else?
There would be nothing there. The monster
the Michelle Bauer
would
scene?
Be empty in the shape of her hand.
The audio between Dick Miller and her is, like, different.
Yes.
And I don't even think they were in the same room. I think that was... They filmed Dick's part, and then somewhere along the line, they thought, hey, you want to have a little part in the movie?
Yeah, with
and
Michelle
they just
Bauer.
Threw her in there.
They 100% did.
And then
they
had
did
her
not
acting.
Look like the same or sound the same at all.
No, because her audio is worse than
yes,
his.
Yes, it is. So that was like a post scene when they made everything.
It was an add-in, yeah.
Yeah.
They're like, oh, let's get some more tits
and
in
what we 100%. Did is a place called Kinemation had an unusual system of shooting off an aerial suspended lens, and they would project the plate onto the back of the lens, and we'd hang
I'm sorry, Ray, you're
the
trying to
animation
sell it really
cell
well.
In
that
front,
was still
and
bad.
Then we would re-photograph it. So we'd see the animation cell first, and then you would see the background plate coming through the clear parts of the acetate. And it became very technical when the monster would jump on the girl, and then he like sniffed her top and it flew off. And so she would fall down, and there would be wires, which you can see in this footage that you're looking at right now.
Oh yeah, they are. Look at
the
wires.
Are pulling and pulling, and they finally pull her. They pull her top off.
Yeah.
And then the finish scene, you know, it looked like he was jumping around and grabbing onto her and stuff. So it was a really very clever way of combining these two elements, and it didn't cost a lot. I think we spent all of $20,000.
Also, YouTube. This is age restricted for a reason. Kids are not supposed to be watching this.
These elements. Over again. The biggest
just
part
if you try
sure
to strike this channel with something stupid, just that's why it's age restricted.
It was very precise because
Duh.
Any shifting in the gait of the
it's
chair
done before
would
to me without something that shows any
monster.
Titties on it,
of
which
course,
is
as
stupid.
You've seen the film, everything turned
all
out
my stuff
just
always
fine.
For 18
so we made the picture, and Chuck Screener did a tremendous score. It has seen a lot of distribution. It has played around
well,
the world in
of,
several
I will
different
get the score for this movie
just like this
posted
one.
On posted in the channel of movie music.
Really?
The full film was also on Tubi.
That's the that's the Monique Gabriel right there.
It is.
And that's one of the that's one of the forgettable blondes.
Pourquoi tu regardes pas le bouquin? Il doit y avoir d'autres moyens. Bon alors. Oh, j'ai bien trop peur. Mon cerveau réagit pas.
Yeah, she's the brainy one. She's the only one that can read Latin.
Yep. And she fucks up by reading it too. There's a mention of Mesocotonic University in this fucking movie too, which both angered me and made me laugh at the same time. Because it's supposed to be like, oh, I'm reading from the Necronomicon.
If we were going to have a blooper outtake reel with this special edition, the answer is no.
No.
After, I don't even know how many years it's been. 1990, so it's been 11 years. Most of all those elements, if there were any, I always like to say, that the bloopers and the mistakes are all in the film, but any of those elements that we might have had have long since gone their own way. There is one goofy outtake that remains, and we've transferred it for you, and here it is.
Here's the goofy outtake.
Action.
The three of them try to drag him across the floor. It's hilarious.
They do.
The kitchen.
Because he's like a big guy.
Mm-hmm. How do you think this happened? Who knows? Looks like Roxanne gave him a terminal hickey. Okay, let's do it. Okay, we can
All right,
yeah.
Go, girls, go. You're almost there. Keep going.
Yep.
So over the years, the one thing I have maintained is I have kept all the animation cells. And who
knows
how many
did.
They are. They're all in a big box. Somewhere in your DVD and on this disc, you'll find an offer to where you can actually have one of these animation cells.
Why would you buy it, Ray?
It's free for the cost of a stamp. So
oh,
find
okay.
Your way
well,
over
look
to
at
the
you.
iTunes,
you don't want
offer
it, obviously.
And, grab yourself one of these animation cells. They're all one of a kind, and you'll probably never get a chance like this again.
You'd have
well,
the, what, the honor of having an Evil Toons animation
you'll enjoy
cell?
This disc and this
I mean, that's pretty cool, though. Because
oh,
well, of how exploitive he is in making money and what he's done to make money.
Yeah.
To, for him to just give that away is pretty cool.
It is, I agree.
Because you wouldn't expect that. You'd expect, like, oh, I'm just,
oh,
they're
yeah.
going to be, you know, 50 bucks a pop.
So I don't remember if we've watched Phoebe Cates yet for Ultimate Sci-Fi Babes, but we're watching her now.
I think we
wouldn't be Fred Olin Ray if you didn't follow it up with titties.
Yeah.
Fast Times at Ridgemont High. Gremlins, obviously, the girlfriend Gremlins. And Gremlins 2, she's in the second movie as well. Probably have.
Kevin Klein.
Yep.
Who I don't really care for.
No.
And the only thing I can think of him in is that Western Silver something.
Oh yeah, I forget what it's called.
With,
I know what you
with
mean.
Kevin Costner and
he is.
And the guy in Rambo.
Oh yeah, that's right.
Brian Denny, he's in it. And it's not very good.
No.
And then he's in what? He's in the Wild Wild West with
Will Smith.
Isn't he?
Yeah.
With Will Smith? Yeah.
Yeah, he is. That one. She had probably known her roles in films like Fast Times at Ridgemont High. Gremlins 2. Gremlins 2 is really good. A lot of people didn't like it. I'm really surprised they didn't.
Yeah, it's Silverado.
Silverado.
I'm talking about Kevin Klein.
Silverado. Oh, that's what you, yeah, that's the thing. Silverado.
Girl in Ferris Bueller's Day Off?
Is that Porky?
Is she in Ferris Bueller's Day Off?
Is she? I don't know. I'm not sure.
Oh, that's Mia Sara.
Oh, that's what you're thinking of.
Yeah.
You know how cute I always thought you were.
The most memorable bikini drop in cinema history. Rolling Stones.
Yeah,
it is pretty
actually,
famous.
You know what? Mia Sara might be the girl that's married to Kevin Klein.
It
funny.
Was just the same thing over and over. After a while, I did it solely for the money. Yeah, that sounds about right. Talking about Hollywood, eventually you just do it for cash. All the passion's gone. For some people. Mostly for most people, I'd say, but...
Today's movie's another 80s video...
Alright, Porky, we're gonna watch Brandon talk about Trancers,
ooh,
one of your favorite movies.
Trancers.
Movie's another 80s video store classic,
so
before
fun.
We get into that,
that's
I just want to say thanks again to Squarespace for sponsoring this video. That's right, Squarespace. The best way to make your own website, whether you're trying to launch that new business you've always wanted, or just want to show off what you're into. It doesn't matter what your passion is.
I'm going to pause it. He is known for shilling hard for that, like, it came from the 80s stuff and all other things, too. He's one of those people because he's backing it. The guy behind that is a piece of shit. That's Oliver Harper or whatever his name is. He is an awful fucking person. And greedy. Very greedy, too.
Whether it's painting, photography, blogging, or hey, maybe you're just old and sign up for the day. Josh Kirby. Before I've largely avoided the one your site's ready for launch, use the promo code BrandonTenold for 10% off your first purchase.
Oh no,
all
right,
let's get into
Kevin Harper.
Kevin Klein was
I've done some Charles Band movies on here before, but so far I've largely...
What was that, Porky?
I was right. First time.
Okay.
Phoebe Cates
avoided
is married
the ones
to
that became franchises.
Kevin Klein.
Yeah, a Puppet Master
Mia
is probably
Sara
the granddaddy of them all, but with
Brian Henson.
Mm, I see. Huh.
What's his name's kid?
Jim Henson's.
Yeah, Jim Henson's kid.
Huh, that's interesting.
Yeah.
Movie so far and a 15th on the way. I don't know if I have it in me to start that one. Okay, let's see. Ghoulies, no. Subspecies, no.
But Brendan's not the only Prehysteria, person that shows ownership, by the way. I'm not
Josh
him out
Kirby, no.
The Bedflix.
Ah, Trancers. That one works.
And I like Cecil. And I do like Brendan too, but it's definitely noticeable that you'd have that kind of, you know, shill going on.
There are three Trancers movies and
yes,
one
there are.
Trancers,
short.
Also known.
Yes, there is.
There's a Trancers 1.5.
Yes, there is. And there's that
and
movie
I think
that
we
was
watched
supposed
the first two.
Yes, we did. And we had plans to watch the third one at some point, but I don't think we ever have.
Yeah, and I don't think they're on Tubi anymore.
I don't think they are either, but I'll check later. The biggest thing I was going to say is that... what was it? Fucking... Lance Hendrickson and the guy that's the main star in Trancers are good friends, and they want to do that movie of Bring Me the Head of Lance Hendrickson. That's a project they have going on.
Tim Thomerson?
Tim Thomerson and Lance Hendrickson are really good friends. Yes, that's correct. And it was all about like him killing Lance Hendrickson for being
more
famous.
We're going to be watching a movie later.
Known as Future Cop, it's a 1984 sci-fi movie that, depending on your age, you may have seen sitting on video store shelves in the 80s and 90s, even if you didn't actually end up renting it. Produced and directed by Charles Band for his company Empire International Pictures, it also features a script by Danny Bilson and Paul DeMeo, who would later go on to write The Rocketeer for Disney. Oh, yeah, and it cool. also had an early role for some actress named Helen Hunt.
Yeah, very cute.
I don't really know what happened to her. Trancers usually gets overshadowed by more popular Empire releases like Troll and Reanimator, but it's still one of the movies that really put Charles Band on the map and ended up becoming a minor cult hit. It probably would have been an even bigger hit if the poster showed the main character coming up out of the toilet like in Ghoulies. Now there's an image that really jumps out at you. Anyway, the movie is set in a retro-futuristic version of Los Angeles in the 23rd century called Angel City, and as you can probably tell, this is highly influenced by Blade Runner in both design and hard-boiled voiceover narration.
Last January, I finally singed Martin Whistler out in one of the Rim planets.
Oh, the old January Rim job. Nice work. Tim Thomerson plays future cop Jack Death, which is one of the most awesomely ridiculous names for a character since Sam Hell from Hell Comes to Frogtown.
Oh, hey, Roger.
One step away from naming a character Johnny Badass. Jack supposedly just killed a guy named Whistler, who has the ability to turn people into pseudo-zombie creatures called Trancers that he can control.
Also,
now
Whistler
he's looking for any
bodies.
Leftovers.
Don't mention,
and just
don't
how can you tell
that
somebody's a Trancer?
Souls.
That's a pretty good way to tell.
Yeah, I guess he did kill him.
Jeez, this diner waitress is Tyler Perry's worst character yet. Oh, and do you want to know how you kill a Trancer?
Shoot him.
You just shoot him. Doesn't even need to be in the head. You can just nick their arm and that'll kill them. Not only can Trancers be killed pretty easily, but they also have the decency to clean up after themselves when they die. I gotta say, I do kind of like the look of this part of the movie. Yeah, sure, it's definitely Blade Runner on a budget.
No,
I don't know. Something about the combination of retro film noir elements and 80s neon cyberpunk just kind of does it. Anyway, Jack is visited by Lieutenant Zoot Suit here, who gives him the whole "you're a loose cannon" death, causing him to quit.
What is his name? LeFleur.
Yeah, oh yeah, it is. It's
something LeFleur.
Yes, it is. That's LeFleur who plays the lieutenant.
And what?
But he also
he played Babe Ruth in Sandlot.
Yes, he did. It's Art LeFleur.
Art LeFleur. Yep.
Yes.
Also provides
Who's
some backstory.
Always fun.
He is.
Well, it could be worse. At least a toon didn't kill his brother. Now that he's off the force, Jack can finally enjoy his retirement collecting knickknacks from the sea.
What the sea.
Listen, Jack, you're on the wrong coast.
As
the Statue
God
of Liberty ain't here. Jack is told that Whistler is somehow still alive and gets summoned before the High Council that's apparently in charge now. And I know I make fun, but again, for a low-budget movie, there is some style to this. Okay, so here's where the main plot of the movie kicks off. Turns out Whistler's traveled back in time and is eliminating the ancestors of the council members so they don't exist in the future. And we know this because he straight up told them that.
No, this is I who am solely responsible for your demise. One by one, your ancestors shall be murdered.
Okay, well, nice of Whistler to explain his whole plan before he's finished.
Good job.
If he had just done it, they'd probably have no idea what the hell was even happening.
And then he starts monologuing.
One of the council members has already disappeared, but hey, the other two are still here, so Whistler's plan must have failed, right? Mission accomplished. Nah, it's a time travel movie, so of course things aren't that simple. But the method they use for time travel is actually pretty clever. Instead of stepping into a machine, they use a drug that sends their consciousness into the body of one of their ancestors while their body stays behind. Okay, so it's sort of like the Days of Future Past method of time travel, but still, it is more creative than your typical 80s B-movie. Whistler's inhabiting the body of a police inspector called Weisling, while Jack will inhabit the body of his ancestor, Phil Deathton, which is not quite as cool a name as Jack Death. They also found Whistler's body while his mind is in the past. Now they can lock him up until they send his mind back.
You're our only hope.
And it's on my terms.
Just fucking shoot his body. Yeah, he did that.
Or just shoot him. I guess since time travel exists, they can travel to the future and see if he was found guilty and got the death penalty. Before his trip, they give Jack a gun containing two vials that'll send him back to their own time, as well as something else.
If you depress this knob, you'll gain a long second. 1 second.
Oh, that's right, the long second. Remember that, Porky?
Yeah, that was fun.
Hey, bullet time watch. Very nice. Couple things you should know about 80s Los Angeles, Jack. Bad news, they don't have your favorite hair dye. Good news, it comes with partial Helen Hunt nudity. Helen Hunt plays Lena, the girlfriend of Jack's ancestor. And in case you were wondering just what kind of guy Jack's forefather was.
Did you mean what you said last night?
What did I say last night?
Phil, come on. You said that making love to me was like the ethereal union of two lost souls.
Jeez, my ancestor was a real pretentious douchebag.
Yeah. I can't wait till Christmas is over so I can dump this.
Ah, yes, it's a Christmas movie. I forgot about
that. Damn it, I should have waited until Christmas to do this one. Yeah, well, people usually don't think of this as a Christmas movie, even though they really should.
Yeah.
Hashtag Trancers is a
went
Christmas
down the ball
movie.
And
you won't be getting Jack Death to put on no Santa's suit.
You're wearing that?
Hey, I gotta look cool for the poster, baby. You know, Jack, regarding your current situation, you've got a nice apartment, a cute young girlfriend, LA isn't underwater. You know, instead of hunting Whistler, maybe you should just stay here. First, though, he's gotta drive Lena to work. She's gotta push Ralphie down the slide.
And what would you like Santa to bring you for Christmas this year?
Okay, remember, kid, ask for the Castle Grayskull playset.
And John Doe's Mandroid.
What's wrong with Murray?
He's a trancer.
A what?
Look, it's 80s LA. Just say he's a tweaker. She'll get the idea.
Tweaker.
And if anyone didn't think this is a Christmas movie, look at this. We've got psycho zombie Santa fighting a hard-boiled future cop. If that doesn't say the reason for the season, I don't know what does.
Hey, Jack, what do you say we play Silent Night, Deadly Night? I'll be Santa and you can be Linnea Quigley's tits.
Yep. That's a reference.
Santa Claus.
And from that day forward, little Timmy would spend every Christmas morning waking up screaming. They don't see any sign of Whistler, but it should be pretty easy to find him. His ancestor also happens to look exactly like him. Then again, I guess that's not the most unbelievable thing about this movie. Jack tells Lena everything, and she seems to buy it almost immediately.
Look, you're not my prisoner. You don't have to stick around, but I'd appreciate you waiting for me.
Relax, Phil.
Jack. Phil stepped out.
Yeah, and when he comes back, he can see Jack just left
That's
town.
Such a cool
Jack
line.
Finds one of the councilman's ancestors. Okay, at least this guy isn't also played by the same actor. But bad news, Jack, he's also a trancer. Either that or his
that
last
work?
Tanning session went horribly wrong. And instead of just killing him while he's unconscious, guess what he does?
A tanning booth. Walk-in tanning booth.
That's right, Jack. He's gonna kill you with melanoma. Just how strong were tanning beds in the 80s? It's burning through his clothes? Lena comes by later to save him, but I'm sure he'll be okay. Oh, sweet God! Of course, Jack's fine. They didn't even hurt his one-liners.
How's my tan?
Are you okay?
All right, Whistler's got more goons outside, so they'll have to carefully sneak out the back. Okay, that didn't work at all.
Whistler.
None other. Farewell,
Why does his ancestor look just like him?
Yeah, well, I still got the more badass name, asshole. Oh, and remember when I called Jack's watch a bullet time watch earlier? It's literally a bullet time watch. Okay, now that time slowed down, you can save Lena and easily use that serum on Whistler to send him back to his own time. Or just walk right past him, whatever you feel like. I mean, you're the cop, I'm not gonna tell you how to do your job. By the way, how long did they say this effect was supposed to last?
1 second, stretch to 10 for the person holding the device.
Yeah, it was
more
like...
Okay, it seemed closer to 100 seconds yeah. on screen, but... Who knows? Maybe his watch is a little slow.
Can I ask you a question?
For that, right?
Yeah, sure.
It was corny, but it wasn't
that bad. Freezer thing. Why didn't you get Whistler right then?
I only had a few seconds. If I'd have singed him, I couldn't have saved you.
Yeah, I think you could have got Whistler if you really wanted to there, Jack. But hey, I'm being a little too hard on Jack. Because you want to know how badass he is?
He is the best character.
That's how he lights his cigarettes.
I mean, it's really
next. He's
going to
open
Tim
a case
Thomerson.
Of beer by
it
shooting
is.
All the caps off, and he's going to do it in one shot.
This isn't much
too.
Different from
well, come
pretty
on,
much every
Jack. You can
plays.
Watch some of the inspiration
oh, yeah,
for this movie later.
Hey, what are you watching?
Some cop show. What the hell kind of name is Peter Dunn?
What kind of name is Jack Depp?
Hey. I'll make the snarky remarks,
wow.
okay, Lena? It also turns out this place is above a music venue, and in case you didn't
oh,
know, it's
part
the
where
80s.
He yeah. Yeah. His punks. I love how he's dressed. Yeah.
He makes sense
real
that Jack's
like,
here.
Yeah,
after all,
like,
Jack Death does sound
down
like the name
whatever.
Of a hardcore punk singer. Like yeah. Oh, and did you hear what song they're playing? That's right, hashtag Trancers is a Christmas movie. Unfortunately, there's a bit of drama when one of Lena's ex-boyfriends shows up.
Lena!
As you do.
How come you don't call me anymore?
I found all your Bay City Rollers records, you poser. Also, I know this is a minor detail, but what the hell is that tattoo on the side of his face?
Oh, I never
it looks
saw
like
that
the
before.
Silhouette
yeah.
of an Ultraman monster.
It does.
Jack steps in to defend Lena's honor, and in case anyone still doesn't know how badass Jack is...
Now I'm
finished. Boom!
One punch.
Yep.
One punch.
Everybody.
One punch. I love it.
That's right. Jack Death was the original One Punch Man. Because we've already established this is a Christmas movie, Lena even gets Jack a present. Oh, hey, I was kind of hoping for Transformers, but, you know,
the
this
age
is
difference
okay,
between these two.
I guess.
Yeah, it's
besides,
kind of creepy.
Lena's about to give Jack
bit...
his real present. Turns out she really has a thing for
like
guys 300
years
younger than her. However, yeah. before Jack can do the nasty and the pasty, he gets a visit from the lieutenant, who,
oh, I love
for
that.
Some
yeah.
reason, is a little girl.
This that's the lieutenant's relative, so that's how it works.
It's been hell. I had to sneak past the parents and everything.
Well, why didn't you just go into the body of one of the parents? I mean, they'd also
be
your ancestors,
nope.
right?
Because this
yeah,
is
yeah,
so much
yeah.
fun
Thanks
watching
for
a little girl with a bunch of attitude.
Now, quit
yeah.
cock-blocking me and get the
yeah,
hell out
he
of here, will
you?
Unfortunately for Jack, McNulty wants to do more than just watch.
Oh, yep. Set back.
Damn it, McNulty. Couldn't you give me an hour?
Okay, come on. 15 minutes tops, Jack. Hey, what's the deal? I was totally going to get
no,
Whistler right after
Jack
I busted
death,
a
asshole.
Nut, I promise. Yeah. Because another council member's been killed, they consider taking Jack off the case. Hey, here's an idea. How about you just send Jack back to before Whistler killed the council members and... You know what?
Stop
I don't
it.
Know why I'm even
Stop
bothering.
It. Stop.
It's a
it's
time
a movie.
Travel
movie.
None
movie.
Of this is going to stand up to scrutiny. Eventually,
no,
they decide to give Jack another chance and even give him another slow-mo watch. Come on, you didn't think they'd blow their whole wad that early in the movie, did you?
Of course
All
not.
Right, Jack, we'll
you
send you back
again.
To the past, but it's going to be after you're done with Lena, got it? Get to work.
That's cock-blocking. You do it, but you don't really do it.
Favorite script for the toothpick.
I said get to work! Ooh, hey, Trancers is on. Hopefully it's not one of the later sequels. Anyway, they find out that the last council member's ancestor, an ex-baseball player called Hap Ashby, is homeless and living on Skid Row. Before
yes,
they can
is.
Find him, though, Jack's gotta get his new supplies.
What is this?
Reload.
That is so cool! Do that.
Something about a drug that sends your mind back through time. I don't really know how it works with objects, so just go with it. Oh, and in case anyone watching forgot that this is a Christmas movie.
Who brought this glorious angel that we two kings were gazing upon?
This is the Christmas angel.
All right, Porky, you know what you need to show for Christmas now.
We're not called three wise men for nothing.
Hashtag Transfers is a Christmas movie. They think Hap Ashby's living in a section of Skid Row, but just their luck. Looks like somebody tipped off the cops they don't have a permit to film here.
Oh, God.
One of them might be a transfer. You know, I just realized, for a movie called Transfers, Joker without there makeup, hasn't been that a ton of transfers so far. There was Diner Lady at the beginning, Psycho Santa Claus, Tanning Salon Dude, and then this guy. You know, considering how prominently John Carl Beekler's listed in the credits, this is some of the most subtle effects work I've ever seen from him.
Yeah,
usually
that's
I'm used to seeing him do stuff like this.
Lieutenant, the stole us all about you, Death.
Oh, TerraVision, that's great. Are you trying to? I love TerraVision.
TerraVision is good. I tried showing it, but YouTube didn't want
to. I enjoy TerraVision because in a river. I know, like,
how the hell is Jack
going to
get out of
like,
this one?
He's doing some kind of commentary on, like,
media.
Materialism and stuff. Transfer.
And it won't be the last one either.
But
Helen Hunt actually came back
so,
for
like,
some
goofy.
Yeah,
it's just fun. It's fun.
Yeah, it's 100% goofy. I mean, Charles Band can say all the stuff he wants to be about media or materialism or anything else, but you know what he is? He's a surfer bra, dude. That's the way he talks. He talks that fucking way because he's a West Coaster. So he has nothing to say on the subject. Not a damn thing, Charles Band, especially with all the money you've made from exploitative shit. So shut up.
And see if you can guess what happens next.
Baseball.
That's right. Hobo baseball. But wait a
second.
How are they going to know which one of these guys is
hobo
the ex-baseball player if they're all playing baseball?
You're Hap Ashby.
Oh, okay. That was easy. All right. Now just get him to sign his own rookie card so it's worth more in the future, and you're all set. Whistler gets there, too, which means they have to hightail it out of there.
Oh, the scooter chase.
And because they didn't have the budget for a big Blues Brothers-style chase scene, this part is mostly a bunch of alleyway shots.
Yes,
hell, the
is.
Biggest stunt we get is Jack riding his motorcycle down a flight of stairs. Well, okay.
They're
there
not
is
even
also
motorcycles.
This.
They're scooters.
They are scooters. Oh, that scene. I forgot about that.
Fun fact, Helen Hunt actually did her own stunts for that part.
Wow.
Nah, I'm fucking with you. She didn't.
Merry Christmas.
Hashtag Transfers is a Christmas movie. They
yes,
managed
Brandon,
to get away.
Get
now they
yeah,
just gotta
to
keep Hap safe until
too.
Jack can get Whistler.
I don't even know your name, man. My name is Death. Jack Death. Your name is Jack Death.
Wow, this movie is getting really meta with Jack's name, isn't it? I don't know. I think it fits Tim Thomerson's character for this movie pretty well. But oh no, the bad guys ruined Lena's favorite sweater. Oh,
oh
and
no.
She's hurt too.
What? What's the matter?
I had a wife in Angel City. She volunteered for a transfer bid. I lost her. I don't want that to happen again.
Hey, I think Jack might be falling in love with his ancestor's girlfriend he just met a day ago. All right, there's less than 10 minutes left, so you better have that final showdown with Whistler quick before the end credits roll.
Yeah.
Operator, give me the police. Lieutenant Weisling, please. Tell him it's Death.
Your name is Jack Death? Seriously?
Jack gets Whistler to meet him in Chinatown and uses Hap as a decoy so he can sneak up on him. Oh, and also this.
Merry Christmas!
Hashtag Transfers is a Christmas movie.
That's six shots, Whistler. The gun is empty.
No, five!
No, it was five.
Okay,
why
I guess there's a reason his name
isn't
Jack Math.
Death.
Let her go, Whistler. She's got a mainstream Hollywood career ahead of her. I'm strictly direct-to-video. Take me instead. And how's this for a bombshell? Turns out Lena's Jack's ancestor, too.
Oh, what
if
the fuck?
If he marries the girl, I would have had she lived. And now Jack Death. Prepare to witness your own demise.
Woo! Great,
come on,
great,
Whistler, you missed the perfect one-liner opportunity there.
Great,
you're not
going
to say something like, prepare to become
so
Jack.
So she's older than him, technically,
dead.
Porky, which doesn't
and
make it
and there's a few
weird,
minutes
okay?
left. Better use that last
that
watch,
Big
Jack.
Long second.
Okay, now you just need to quickly run down the stairs and catch her before she hits the ground.
For this.
Or just do that. That was probably cooler than what I said. And as far as Whistler goes, remember how they set up that Hap was a baseball player?
That's right, hit him with garbage.
Yeah, that's right. You're defeated by a fastball, motherfucker.
But he's not
Jack
dead.
Plans to send Whistler back to the future without a body to go to, which would trap him in time limbo or something. However, one of his vials is damaged.
Lose again, Jack. Only one of us can return now.
Okay, this seems like a pretty easy fix. I mean, we've already established that the people in the future are keeping an eye on you and can just send you stuff. So just take care of Whistler and then have him send you another vial.
No?
No.
Is that not how it works? Okay.
Because Whistler's ancestor is technically an innocent man, rather than shoot him, Jack decides to use the vial on him and frees Weisling from his control.
Where am I?
A bunch of time travel shit. I would try to explain it, but I don't really understand.
Don't worry, your ancestor's dead now.
So I guess Jack is just stuck in the 80s and can't go back now. Not that he seems to care.
No.
I can't get home now.
That's okay. I kind of like it here.
Hey, nice work, Jack. I'm happy for you. I really am, but there's just
you know
one
what Jack is?
Small problem with this
I
whole
just
situation.
Realized he's a Leosexual.
He is. He is?
Yeah. Leosexual, for everybody who doesn't know, is are men who are only attracted to women between 18 and 25.
Woo!
And as soon as they turn 26, they're no longer attractive. And
then he
must
go back
move on to
the
a younger girl.
He has to go back to the future at that point.
It's Leosexual
because of Leonardo DiCaprio.
Ancestor, but he seems to have
really
zero problem staying behind
that's really
Phil's
what it comes
body
from.
And being
oh,
with Lena, even though he's stealing his ancestor's life. So, is Phil's mind just floating around in limbo, too?
Yep.
If so, that is a shitty thing to do to one of your relatives, Jack. I know I joked you should just stay here earlier, but I didn't think you'd actually do it. Also, didn't they say Lena's his ancestor, too? Doesn't that mean he's technically getting with his great-great-grandmother
well,
or something?
He is his own grandfather.
Oh, God, it's the fucking Futurama episode all over again. Oh, no. Oh, no. No wonder he's a time paradox.
Oh well, McNulty's still there to watch over them and sequel bait. While not exactly a hit in movie theaters, Transfers did much better once it hit video store shelves.
It did.
To the point where Charles Band
Holy
ended up making
fuck.
Five sequels.
Oh no.
There's
but
five?
I don't think Timmer Thomerson's in all of them.
No, he seems to be up to five, and then that's not him at fucking six. Holy shit, Charles Band.
I would say, though, only three of them are good.
Yeah.
Because they did the first one, and it took, because it wasn't a hit immediately, it was a hit on, like, home sales.
Yes.
So it took a while to accumulate some money to be like, oh, hey, we need to make a sequel. So I want to say, like, one came out, like, early, late 80s, and then two and three came out within a year of each other in, like, sometime in the 90s.
Mm-hmm. But he is in 4 and 5, too, as you can see. That's him on the fucking cover. So maybe they use stock footage of him. I'm not sure. But he is definitely in 2 and 3.
Yeah.
So, holy fuck, 6 looks so bad. Look at that shit. That's so, like, that looks like fucking 2010, like, direct-to-video sci-fi shit. That looks so bad. Woo!
Transfers was 84.
And surprisingly,
Transfers
Helen
2 and
Hunt
3 is 91 and 92.
Yeah. And then after that, I'm sure there's
And then 94. Mm-hmm. Oh, then 2 and 94. And then 2002 for Transfers 6.
Okay. Oh, that's
Transfers City of the Lost Angels came out in 88. So that was 4 years after
that's
the first
That's the
movie.
3.5 one?
The 1.5.
The 1. Okay, yeah.
Actually
yeah, we
came
watched that
back for
on
two
TV
of them. So, did Transfers deserve to become a franchise?
And Helen Hunt was in that too.
Yeah, she was. She's in most
in fact,
of them until like.
I think
three.
Helen Hunt goes to 3, and that's
yes.
it.
Then she stops.
I'd say, yeah.
She had a main
it's no classic like Reanimator or anything, but it's still better than your typical video store sci-fi movie. Even though it's clearly influenced by stuff like Blade Runner,
it
still somehow manages to seem kind of original, which is not
yeah,
that easy for
Jack
a low-budget movie.
Than Harrison
Despite
Ford's
the obvious
character.
Production
Harrison
limitations,
really
it manages
kind of
to include some creative ideas,
yeah.
and Tim Thomerson absolutely owns
Ford
his role as Jack Death.
Oh, he's 100%
Plus, it's just an hour and 16 minutes long, it moves briskly and doesn't overstay its welcome. The plot does kind of fall apart if you think about it too much, but you could also say that about
really
pretty
great.
Much any
yes,
time
are.
Travel movie.
And guess who is also in that movie, Porky?
Yeah, James Hong. He's one of the better bit parts, and so is the other guy that they killed.
Edward James Olmos.
Yep.
They're both really good in that movie.
Hell, even James Cameron reportedly liked it. Probably because it's one of the only Terminator knockoffs that's not actually a knockoff.
Oh, speaking of, though, that's the biggest thing Brendan's been chilling as of lately. Like, Aliens explains the whole, like, big idea to sell this whole thing that James Cameron's doing. I sure do wonder why he's doing that, James Cameron.
Yeah.
It shouldn't be the fact that you have no money for Avatar 2 or anything, you piece of shit, James Cameron. I hate James Cameron so much.
off. Well, now that I did this one, I'll probably have to do all the sequels, but at least there's only five of them instead of 14. Well, it's all for now. Until next time.
He's not a good person. So yes, I'm always very opinionated, but James Cameron is a piece of shit. There's no lie there. He's not the worst out of all people we've talked about, but he is awful. He is pretentious of the ass. I do not like James Cameron at all.
Yeah, the Avatar movies are just a money grab.
It is.
There's nothing that's going to be like original with the storyline.
I skipped it. What the fuck? Got some Minty to watch, Porky.
Oh, nice.
Got some Phantasm. We're gonna learn some facts. The tall man. Angus Scrimm.
In 1979, the world of horror was introduced to a new villain.
Funeral is about to begin, Porky.
A creepy old man who seemingly runs a funeral home, but is in actual fact, the tall man. A sinister killer who compacts his villains to a small size and reanimates them into being his creepy minion slaves. His weapon of choice, a crone ball, which has the ability to fly around on their own to try and stop the tall man's victims, in which these balls are armed with brutal weapons. Yep. That'll no doubt make Pinhead jealous. The tall man is the movie boogeyman of the Phantasm film series.
Yes, he is.
The first film came out in 1979, and it started a popular horror franchise that has now released 5 movies, with the 5th one just coming out in 2016, giving fans of the franchise decades of terror and fear and balls.
The 5th one is the worst.
In which actor Angus Scrimm has brought to life one of the most celebrated horror movie villains ever. As thanks to his creepier-than-hell performances, fans just keep coming back and can't get enough of this film series.
So bad, but still maybe the same guy, it's just he kickstarted it.
So today, we are going to grab Phantasm by the silver balls, as we look into 10 things that you may not know about Phantasm.
Oh, go on.
Probably the only horror movie to have an ice cream van guy as one of its heroes. So sit tight and stay clear of the local graveyard as we step inside the terrifying world
in the graveyard.
Of Phantasm.
If you meet some girl at a bar and she wants to fuck you in the graveyard, just say no.
Yeah. Love that theme. Oh, for, speaking of horror movies with good soundtracks, guess what, Porky? Guess what got released recently?
On vinyl?
Yep.
Nice.
Killer Clowns from Outer Space.
Ooh.
Got released on vinyl by Waxworks.
I'd love to see what the cover looks like.
Oh, it's great. I posted the thing in movie soundtracks and music. Okay. It's really good looking. The vinyl itself looks good, too. They've got the...
Is it a color vinyl?
Yes, 2 color vinyls. It's 2
nice.
Discs. Yeah, yep. It's green.
Is each vinyl a different color, or is it a mix?
I'd say they're both different solid colors. One's pink, one is green. And on the side of one of them, there is like the funhouse looking stuff, cotton candy, and the other shows the popcorn. So
that's
popcorn's
cool.
The eggs. It's
where
really
is
nice.
It? It's in, what's the? Not, it's not in music, it's somewhere else.
It was in music. I posted it there too, I'm sure. Oh, okay. It's in movie soundtracks as well.
Movie soundtracks.
Yep.
A lot of those in the movie and film thing, I don't normally keep up
with.
Yeah,
that's fine.
But.
John Massari is the guy who composed the original soundtrack, besides the song of Killer Clowns from Outer Space, that is the Dickies. Sabaz is included as well. I love that fucking movie. Killer Clowns from Outer Space is a guilty pleasure of mine, as we know. Anyway. First time released on vinyl. Probably because that game's coming out.
Number 10, It Started With a Dream.
Yeah.
No. Phantasm was the brainchild of writer, producer, director Don Coscarelli. And the idea first came to him in his teenage years, after having a nightmare where he was endlessly being chased around corridors by a floating chrome sphere, in which, if the sphere caught him, it would have attached itself to his head and started to drill inside his brain. And if you think that sounds like a pretty fucked up dream, then let me remind you... actually, no, you're right. That's actually a pretty messed up dream. So, alas, as with several great horror movies, it started off as a nightmare, with the director then using the nightmare as a source of creative inspiration. Number 9, inspiration of the title. Without a doubt, Phantasm is a haunting and intriguing name, with a sense of mystery and danger. Coscarelli got the title of his horror masterpiece from Edgar Allan Poe, who would often use the word phantasm in many of his writings.
Yes, he did.
The definition of phantasm is an illusion, or an apparition, or a ghost. So the title seems fitting. However, in a...
So, with that being said, because we watched the movie, we watched the game movie for Phantasmagoria, Phantasmagoria means phantoms of light, because it's the idea of this box, right? It's a box they used in like the 19th century and so... that had projections of ghosts into it, where you could project that on, like, a stage and everything else. One of the most famous is the thing called La Grande Gueule, which was these plays that had these huge puppets and stuff, and, like, scenery and all that, that used the phantasmagoria for a lot of the effects. Pretty interesting. It's a pretty interesting concept in general.
Australia, the movie was renamed to The Never Dead.
The Never Dead.
In Italy, it was called Phantasmi, which means ghosts. And when the movie was released in Turkey, it had its name changed to Psycho.
Thanks,
well, Turkey. I guess the tall man is a psycho, so I guess it kind of works. So, why not? Look, just please tell me that in Turkey, the movie Psycho isn't called Phantasm. Number 8, Story of the Minions.
Minty, for fuck's sake.
The minions are like the tall man's mutant little slaves who do his bidding, because, hey, I guess the guy from another dimension who runs a funeral home is going to need the slaves, right? We never really get a good look at the minions, apart from noticing that they are all small and seem to wear brown robes.
Yes, they do.
Well, the actors who played the minions were in fact children.
Oh,
yeah, that's right. We've been getting scared over these demonic little monsters, and the whole time they were probably just a bunch of kindergartners. Now knowing that
like
the minions were played by
us.
Children, when you watch the heroes attack the minions, it...
oh, that's a fucking scene. Look at that. Reggie's about to fucking deck that fucking Jawa.
No 7-year-olds were hurt in the making of this movie.
Yeah,
sure.
It's Don Coscarelli who's about to
just
be
just remember
hit.
The graves are a lot smaller and thus easier to dig.
Yeah.
You don't want to have adults being, you know, doing stunts, because those are big holes.
Those are
huge holes.
It's
a lot of dirt you got to move.
That is a lot of dirt.
A small child in a shallow grave, it only takes a couple hours, you know? It doesn't take half a day.
This is definitely a movie caption contest material right here. This fucking... Next time I win one, I'm putting this fucking thing
under,
in.
6 feet under, you know, a 6'5", 200-something-pound person, yeah. Not going to have a good day.
No.
Okay.
It just looks kind of bad, like they're beating up a little kid in a Halloween costume or something. Number 7, Universal Takes Over.
Yes, they did. What? Can't play this music, Minty.
The three main protagonists of Phantasm are brothers Michael and Jody, along with Reggie, the ice cream van musician.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's what Reggie
and
does,
the original
no
movie was distributed by Embassy Pictures. However, due to
not
how
critter,
popular Phantasm
promise.
Was, along comes Universal Pictures in 1988 to continue with a sequel, armed with a shiny, glossy approach and a much larger budget.
Oh, God.
However, Universal
yeah.
didn't want to cast the original actor who
no,
played Michael from the first film, whose real name is Michael Baldwin.
Yep.
They kept Reggie Bannister, the ice cream van guy, but Baldwin had to go. Yeah, that's never a good sign when the ice cream man gets to stay but you have to go for Phantasm 2. The part was recast by James Lee Gross, who is probably best known for playing one of the surfer bank robber dudes in the original Point Break.
Yep.
So naturally, Baldwin was pretty pissed off over the decision. He's gone on to call Phantasm 2 a terrible movie.
It is bad.
But the plot thickens, as Baldwin would go on to reprise the role of Michael in Phantasm 3, 4, and 5.
Yes, he did.
It's like they played musical actors or something. Number 6. The tall man isn't really that tall.
No, he's not. Yes, but not.
That's right, believe it or not, but the tall man, a guy whose name would imply imposing height, was actually a pretty short guy. In fact, the scene where the tall man confronts Jody, actor Angus Scrimm had to stand on a box, yes, as the actor who played Jody, Bill Formby, was in fact much taller than him. In order to try and make Scrimm look a lot more taller and imposing, he had to wear suits that were several sizes smaller than what he would normally wear, along with special boots to try and give him height, to make him look taller than he's 6 feet and 4 inches.
Minty, did you just say that's not that tall? You said 6 feet 4 inches is not that tall. 6'4
is in the top.
Yeah.
That's way up there.
That is. I mean, I get it. I get the fact that the tall man's supposed to be like near 7 feet fucking tall. But still, 6'4 is not short, Minty. Why did you say he's not that tall? That's silly. But yeah,
Average height in America, I would say 6'4 is probably in the top 5.
Yeah.
Percentile.
It's not. It's not an average height. Usually, average height is between like 5'10 to 6, kind of. More you'll see like.
You hear that? I'm above average.
Yeah, you are. The biggest thing is like I think for males it's like it's between 5'8 and 5'10 is actually like the normal height comparatively. Yeah. But above six is not. That's not a normal height. I mean, the internet plays the whole thing like, oh, you're behind, you know, under 6, and you're this. Not too many people are actually that fucking tall. It's actually kind of harder to be. It's not unheard of, but it's just not common. It's more common in places like Norway, I think, and other countries like that, like Scandinavian countries, where your people descend from, Porky, so that's probably where you fucking got it from.
Technically, he should be called the medium height man when you think about it.
Come on.
Number 5, the gargantuan original cut.
Oh yeah, the original cut. They cut that but in the fucking movie. I mean, other movies.
The original cut of the movie clocked in at just over 3 hours, but writer and director, Cuscarelli, just thought that this cut would be way too long. Nah, you think? Seriously, I can't watch a movie in a cinema for over an hour and a half until my butt starts to hurt. I dread to think what over 3 hours sitting in a cinema would do to my behind. So the movie was wisely cut down to an hour and 29 minutes, in order to make the movie reach a more reasonable time duration. So with over half of the movie cut, what exactly happened to the rest of the footage?
They put another movie.
Well, some of the footage was found during the 90s and was used for the fourth entry, Phantasm Oblivion, in 1998. Of which I kind of like the idea of not letting the old footage go to waste. However, not all the footage was found.
Nope.
Most of it got lost and hasn't been found since.
Mm-hmm.
So who knows, maybe someday someone will find the entire original lengthy cut of Phantasm.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind watching that.
Nah, that'd be least impressive.
Once. Number 4, X Marks the P.
Why are you doing this? What's up with this?
Yeah, I know, the music is bad. I see Cindy in chat says, Porky, you're above average, period. I'll never say this again.
Wow. Cindy, are you sober?
Phantasm was originally going to be hit with an X rating when it was released,
which
would have limited its box office performance. All because of one moment. When after we see a guard get attacked and killed by the ball sphere, in which we see him pee
dead
afterwards. Because I guess in the land of movies, urine doesn't exist. Okay, I'll admit it. It is a little weird showing piss.
Well,
I mean,
dead.
We never saw Freddy or Jason's or Michael's victims go pee-pee. But still, it's quite strange that one
realistic
shot of wee was going to put the movie in X-rated territories.
Really?
However, thing changed when respected LA Times critic Charles Champlin contacted the ratings classification board and urged
them
to reduce the X rating to an R. So thankfully, they took his advice
honestly,
and did.
Mm-hmm. You pointed out
number 3, the Lost Phantasm
movie.
Movie.
I didn't even notice it.
Mm-hmm. Oh, the piss happened? Yeah.
Yeah, I was like
looking at other things on the screen, I didn't even like, oh, there's
yeah,
stuff
you're
there.
Paying more attention to Michael and his feet twitching too.
Rated X movie over something that like a percentage of the audience isn't even going to notice. It's kind of ridiculous.
Because you're paying more attention to Michael as he's scared and wants to get out of there. Not paying attention to the guy's, like, the only thing I'm paying attention to the guy was his feet twitching as his, like, nerves are dying. I didn't pay attention to the piss.
As a movie.
That's true, here's this.
Director and writer Roger Avery has worked on many great movies throughout his career, including Reservoir Dogs, Pulp Fiction, Silent Hill, Killing Zoe, and The Rules of Attraction. And he was a massive fan of the Phantasm series, so much so that he wrote his own script for a Phantasm movie, titled Phantasm 1999 AD. And when he presented it to Cuscarelli, he liked it and got behind the project, and was up for directing it. But sadly, the cost got in the way of the movie getting into production.
Oh damn, there's four. Four
as the budget
is so good,
would have been about $10 million, and no distributor was interested. So the project was shelved, never to see the light of day.
Four and the first one are all you really need.
Who knows, maybe someday someone would actually dig up that old script and make it. It would probably have to have its name changed and be called Phantasm 2199 or some shit.
2099.
Number 2, Brad Pitt versus the Tall Man.
Oh, yeah.
As mentioned, when Universal took over for the Phantasm sequel, Phantasm 2, in 1988, for whatever reason, they really didn't like Michael Baldwin, so thus didn't want him to return. So when Cuscarelli had the task of recasting the character of Michael, one actor who auditioned and nearly got the role was that of a young Brad Pitt. At the time, Pitt would have been about 25. And he had some small acting up his sleeves, having appeared in TV shows such as Another World, Dallas, and Growing Pains.
Oh, that's right, he wasn't.
However, clearly it wasn't enough to get him the role of Michael in Phantasm 2, and sadly, we never got to see Pitt go face to face with the villainous Tall Man. So instead, Pitt starred in the TV movie To Die Young, and the Phantasm 2 production went with James Lee Gross.
Yes, it did.
Number 1, Something Phantasm This Way Comes.
Damn with the music, Minty.
Oh my gosh, Minty, stop.
The movie Phantasm got made because Cuscarelli originally wanted to make a movie about a pre-existing story but couldn't get the rights. Mm. You see, it was while directing the movie Kenny & Co. that Reggie Bannister, who played Reggie in the Phantasm, told Cuscarelli that he should adapt the classic horror novel Something Wicked This Way Comes into a modern horror movie.
Oh, I see.
And Cuscarelli was intrigued by the idea. However, Cuscarelli quickly discovered that author Ray Bradbury sold the rights of Something Wicked This Way Comes to Disney.
Yes, he did.
So undeterred, Cuscarelli decided to then make a horror
movie,
make it his own original story instead. And so he directed Phantasm, which has become a cult classic and successful franchise. Whereas Disney eventually made Something Wicked This Way Comes in 1983.
Yes, they did.
And, well, does anyone actually remember that movie?
Yeah.
Sadly, given the fact that Tall Man actor Angus Scrimm died not too long after the fifth Phantasm movie that was made in 2016, it's probably not very likely that we'll be seeing any more Phantasm movies.
Won't. That was supposed to be.
So let's take the time to celebrate the five Phantasm movies that we do have, and continue to celebrate the haunting efforts of the Tall Man, and his high-reaching efforts that he has made to terrify movie audiences. Anyway, I'm Minty, and when it comes to movie boogeymen, the Tall Man has the biggest balls. See ya.
Alright. Oh. I think you didn't know about House 1986. Come on, shall we, Porky?
Yeah. Why didn't you trademark your own pseudonym? Why would I?
Oh, here we go. I'm just pausing it. So let's go back. Are you ready for feminist fail, Porky?
Is this Hulk?
Why didn't you trademark your own pseudonym? Why would I? Did Doctor Strange have to trademark his name? Did Thor? You chose two examples of people who use their real names.
That's what you get, you dumb bitch!
Oh, look what it is, Porky. Fright Night.
When I was a small child, I remember going to a video store and seeing a VHS copy of the movie Fright Night on the shelf. and I was immediately captivated by the movie's poster. The picture of the vampire face in the night sky really drew me in. And that, ladies and gentlemen, was my introduction into Fright Night. Released in 1985, it tells the story of teenager Charlie Brewster, a lover of classic horror movies, whom, after spotting some odd happenings from his bedroom window, believes that his new next-door neighbor, Jerry, is a vampire. And of course, Charlie's friends, Amy and Evil Ed, don't believe him. And after Charlie tries to expose Jerry, the smooth, slick, frightful vampire threatens to kill Charlie. Charlie manages to get help from Peter Vincent, a movie actor who starred in old Hammer Horror-esque vampire movies, whom knows all about how to kill vampires. Both Charlie and Peter must go next door and confront the menacing vampire on the Fright Night they'll never forget. Fright Night was kind of a mishmash of 1980s horror meets old-school classic horror movies, and celebrates them both, and also has a rear window approach added to it for good measure.
There is
especially considering how a huge chunk of the movie is about Charlie seeing atrocities from his bedroom window, in which no one believes him.
When it's
which, in effect, would go on to put his own life in...
I said Suspiria. I meant Disturbia. That's what I meant to say.
Yeah.
That's Suspiria. Suspiria. Danger.
So get ready for the fright of your life, people, as we check out 10 things that you may not know about this teenage vampire movie from the 80s. As we
explore, I know what you're gonna play.
Fright
Night. I watched that.
Good.
Yeah. It made me more interested in watching the original.
Yeah.
But
the remake.
Yeah.
Also, can we talk about the fact it's all fucking Charlie's fault that this shit happens? He could have just let him
pretty
be.
Pretty much.
He could have just fucking let him
he
be.
Kept
but
pushing
nope.
him.
Yep. Hashtag justice for Harry. No justice, no crosses.
Number 10, The Boy Who Cried Wolf.
Really,
we all
like
know the legend
too.
About the boy who cried wolf, in which a young boy keeps telling tales of atrocities that happen which aren't true. But when something bad finally does happen, no one believes him on the account of his bad habits of telling lies. Well, Fright Night director Tom Holland also wrote the script for Fright Night,
and he
wanted to base it on the notion of the boy who cried wolf, as he thought it would be an interesting and fun take on an old legend, giving it a more horrific,
like
ghoulish approach. Biggest difference is Charlie doesn't tell lies, but has an extreme love for old horror movies,
leads
people to believe his imagination gets the better of him, and that his paranoia is the result of his love of the horror genre.
Yes, Charlie. You've already caused your friends quite enough pain.
Holland wrote the script in 3 weeks, and by his own admission was laughing the whole time while writing it, and admits he loved the idea of a horror movie fan being convinced that his neighbor is in fact a...
I was going to say, there was a documentary made about this movie too, called You're So Cool, Brewster. It was on Shudder for a while. I don't know if you can still buy it or anything else. Tom Holland comes off as kind of both likable and really pathetic in that fucking documentary.
Huh.
It's weird.
Which, when you think about it, is an interesting and original concept. Number 9, Pirate Audio Commentaries.
Oh yeah, that's true. That happened as well.
When Fright Night was finally released on DVD in the early 2000s, this was the amazing list of special features the movie had to offer. Yep, that's right. Absolutely nothing. Okay, technically there was the trailer for the movie, but screw the trailer. That's hardly a special feature when you think about it. So if anyone wanted to get any insights into the making of the movie, they wouldn't have been able to via the DVD, that's for sure.
I don't understand you. First you want to make love and then you don't.
However, in 2008, some of the cast and crew made unofficial, downloadable audio commentary tracks with a company called Icons of Fright. I really like this idea. It's kind of sticking it to those behind the DVD release, who underestimated Fright Night and just assumed that no one would be interested in any other materials related to the movie. Despite the fact that the commentaries weren't official products of the Fright Night brand, they were eventually added to the Blu-ray release of the movie.
Wow.
Number 8. William Ragsdale auditioned for another 80s classic before he got the role of Charlie.
Oh, okay, what the audition?
In Fright Night, William Ragsdale plays the paranoid teenager Charlie Brewster, who is the main protagonist. In order for the movie to work, the audience has to be able to relate to his shock and terror of learning that his neighbor is a vampire and is out to get him, along with the added horror that no one believes him.
If he's not a vampire, have him touch this.
Oh, Charlie.
And thus putting his fear of his strange neighbor down to his love of old horror movies. And Ragsdale plays the part perfectly. However, shortly before he landed the role of Charlie, he auditioned for Rocky Dennis in the movie Mask. He didn't get the part on the account that went to Eric Stoltz. However, Ragsdale then auditioned for Fright Night, and ironically enough, found out he got the part for Fright Night on Halloween of all days.
That's hilarious.
Wow.
Creepy? Okay, awesomely creepy, but still pretty creepy.
In addition to that, actor Stephen Geoffrey, who played Evil Ed, Charlie's weird and obnoxious friend who turns foe, accidentally turned up for an audition to Weird Science on the account that he and actor Anthony Michael Hall had the same casting agent, and she sent him to the audition by accident.
You really believe me, you poor dope?
Is he gonna mention the fact what he did? Don't Google that dude's name, by the way, you will not...
Chris Sarandon's reaction to the script.
Just warning you now. Someone else did. There was a
lot. Yeah, the black cop. The black cop. He was a cop in Die Hard 2.
Yes, he was. That's true.
Like the same character. That's why when you see him, it's like, wait a minute. I know that.
I've seen this guy. I know who he is.
The casting process of the movie, we may as well mention the casting of Jerry, who was played devilishly by actor Chris Sarandon, who also starred as the villain in The Princess Bride, along with a cop in Child's Play, also directed by Tom Holland, and voiced Jack Skeleton in Tim Burton's A Nightmare Before Christmas.
Really?
Well, back in the early production of Fright Night, Sarandon wasn't quite a big star yet, and when approached about taking on the role, he was a little apprehensive about it. To put it bluntly, he didn't want to do it.
Fool.
He hated the idea of playing a vampire, he hated the idea of starring in a horror movie, and he didn't really want to work with a first-time director. However, he quickly changed his mind when he read the script. And indeed, the captivating script won him over instantly, making him want to take part in the project. And adding to that, Sarandon also added some of his own ideas into the character, by making him part fruit bat.
Yes, he did.
Which is Stephen why we often Jeffries, see the character munching away on...
Who plays Evil Ed?
Yes.
He's from Cincinnati, Ohio.
He's an Ohio boy?
Yep.
Oh, God. I really hope you didn't, like, I hope you safe searched his fucking name.
I'm just IMDBing it, so...
Okay, good. Smart, okay. Smart man, because you'll see what his credits are by doing that, and you don't want to Google search that.
On fruit...
He was in one other horror.
Just adding some small details like that just makes the character that bit more interesting.
Number 6, the library ghost from Ghostbusters makes a cameo.
Yes, it does.
Sort of.
Kinda.
Movie special effects wizard Richard Edlund got involved in the project straight away after working on the classic supernatural comedy Ghostbusters. Mm-hmm. Giving the special effects in the movie that added touch of spooktacular magic we had previously...
I don't remember if Minty mentions it or not in this video, but again, this actor almost got blinded by that fucking shit, which is like sulfuric acid. It almost got in his eyes, and he had to go to the hospital. It was bad.
...seen in Ghostbusters.
He was not happy.
However, one of the effects made for Ghostbusters would make its way into Fright Night, as the prop that was originally going to be the library ghost in Ghostbusters... was recycled and used as the giant vampire bat seen at the end of Fright Night, when Charlie and Peter Vincent have a final showdown with Jerry. The bat monster was rejected from Ghostbusters on the account it was believed to be too scary for that movie.
And I'm not surprised on the account that this thing looks like an evil winged demon.
It does.
Yeah, seriously, that thing would have caused many nightmares and therapy sessions. However, it works perfectly here in Fright Night. Number 5, the origin of Peter Vincent's name.
Oh gee, I sure wonder where that came from, Minty. That's a real unknown fact.
In Fright Night, we see the movie's secondary hero, the washed-up, middle-aged horror movie actor Peter Vincent, who hosts a midnight horror show called Fright Night, who, by the end of the movie, regains some of his motivation back into life. The character is a homage to old horror movies.
No, really?
And if you need proof of this, then just look at the character's name, Peter Vincent. As the character is named after Vincent Price and Peter Cushion, two legendary veterans of horror
movies. No, you're making that up.
However, also, Roddy McDowell...
Also really good friends. I think Roddy McDowell knew them, too, in life.
Yeah.
Roddy McDowell, who played Peter Vincent, also put his own spin on the character, too, as he did not want to play the part like Vincent Price as originally scripted. He wanted to portray the character as a failed actor, just more or less starring as the same cheesy character in every movie he has starred in.
Yep.
I used to admire you,
well,
you know
make
that?
You failed.
No, of course. That was
you just get
I found out what a fake you were.
Which does give the character more of a washed up failed approach and adds
Again,
an extra dynamic into the
failed. It's more just he doesn't
yeah,
get those
you
roles
play,
anymore because those movies
when you
stop
get typecast.
Yeah.
Yeah, you have a really good run for a few years.
Mhm.
And then you're typecast, and you kind of play the role out, and not everybody's going to love it forever.
No, and the biggest thing is you
And that doesn't mean you're a failure, just because, you're not popular doing the same thing over and over and over again forever.
No, it doesn't mean that at all. What it means is the way you make money is becoming a guy who goes to conventions playing that character and signing shit. That's all that you do after that. You don't have to play any roles. If you get another role, good for you, but everything else, or they do something else, sure, but that's not going to happen every day. And what you end up doing is just go to conventions and sign that shit.
The character. However,
that's
jump to the 2010 remake, where
too.
This time Peter Vincent is a stage illusionist, played by David Tennant, who basically just
himself.
Plays him as the 10th Doctor.
You
of course
have
he
to
does, that's all he can play too.
Seriously?
Yeah. Again, that's the thing with David Tennant, that's like the only role he's ever played, technically, as the Doctor. I mean, that's notable, I mean, he's in other shit too, he's in that fucking Harry Potter movie as like a young person at that point and everything else, but still his whole thing is like, oh, he plays the 10th Doctor, so does he get other roles? Sure he does, but he still plays the typecast of being the fucking Doctor.
Well, you got fire, beheading.
Yeah, he's definitely the 10th Doctor. Hey, I'm not complaining because I love David Tennant in Doctor Who, but yeah, he's basically just playing the 10th Doctor. Or rather, a sleazy version of the 10th Doctor, anyway.
Some people
back on the original movie, McDowell's approach of the role must have worked, as Vincent Price himself apparently loved the movie.
Well, he knows Roddy too, that helps.
Number 4. To date, there are 4 Fright Night movies.
There are.
Whenever Fright Night gets brought up, more than often, people are going to instantly think of the original 1985 movie. However,
really
there was a sequel in 1988, which saw Charlie Brewster go to college, where this time Jerry's sister, Regine, is hunting the hapless teenager, takes over Peter Vincent's Fright Night show. For some strange reason, Fright Night 2 had very limited release, which I believe caused it to be not very well known and to slip under the radar, so to speak. Because it's actually not really a bad film.
It's not
then in
that
2010 we got the remake, which is a retelling of the original Fright Night, only this time it's set in Las Vegas and feels more like a contemporary horror movie rather
like
than a homage to the horror days of old. As mentioned, the film stars David Tennant as Peter Vincent and Colin Farrell as Jerry, who I think actually does a really good job
here?
And makes the character really creepy and sinister and intimidating. However, I find the remake hard to watch now, on the account of the death of its main star, Anton Yelchin, who recently passed away.
Oh, fuck, he's
dead. No, he got pinned against his own gate.
Oh, fuck.
He lived, like, up in the hills in Hollywood, and he was driving his SUV, and he had to get out to open his gate.
Oh.
It's pretty bizarre. I almost think his family tried to sue, like...
Oh, the gate company?
Like, Jeep or Chrysler or something.
Yeah.
But Yeah, either the car didn't lock into into park or something, but yeah, the car rolled
and pinned him.
And pinned him. Ooh. I'm pretty sure that's what happened.
Still, either way, fuck that as a death. I don't want to ever think about being crushed.
And it sucked because that was like halfway through the Star Trek. I think the last Star Trek movie they had to make without him, Star Trek Beyond.
Oh, yeah, that's true, because he was Kurt, right?
No, he was, who was he? He wasn't Kurt. Bones.
Was he Spock?
No, he wasn't the...
Was
he was
the
really, really smart guy. He had the kind of a not Russian accent.
Oh, you mean... No, it's not McCoy. It's, Chekhov. He's Chekhov.
Chekhov, yep. He played Chekhov. Which okay. is like... Which is like, okay. How are we going to explain Chekhov's gone? He's
I mean,
like,
Chekhov did
can't,
die
can't have
in,
Star
like, the
Trek
second
without
movie. Because that's Khan. He ends up dying in that. But, still, it's like, how do you do that when he's already dead? You can't really, like, write around that. I understand, like, you can't have the scenes filmed.
Yeah.
That's rough.
We then get Fright Night 2, New Blood, and this is where things get really confusing. Released in 2013, you would think that this straight-to-video release was a sequel to the 2010 remake, with them even following the tropes of the original Fright Night 2, of making the main villain a female vampire.
But no.
But that's not true.
Titties.
As this is actually yet another remake of the original Fright Night.
What?
Yep, the same story just told all over again. Only this time it really sucked. And calling it Fright Night 2 literally makes no sense.
Yeah.
Look. I like the story of Fright Night and all, but the same story can only be told so many times.
At least
number three,
you know, not
Fright Night's
way,
comics. Released by Now Comics, which ran from 1988 to 1990, the Fright Night comics furthers the adventures of Charlie Brewster and Peter Vincent's
You're so
struggles
cool,
against
Brewster.
The blood-sucking vampires of the night. In stories that include taking on bats who latch onto people's heads
That's
and control
weird.
Their bodies, along with a really bizarre issue where the police actually enlist Charlie and Peter's help to stop some menacing squid men, okay, and another issue about a boy who can transform himself into a spider. In other words,
weird.
This comic was pretty batshit insane, and had some wild and far out there ideas. The series would even see the return of the Evil Ed character, who wants to get out revenge on his old friend Charlie, and even has gangs of minions.
Wow.
Number two, the Fright Night sequel, which never happened.
Telementi.
Although, as mentioned, Fright Night would go on to see a sequel and string of remakes,
oh, yeah,
Tom Holland actually had his own idea of a sequel in mind, which would see the Charlie Brewster character as a single father of teenage children
what?
In his mother's home that he inherited, only to discover that his old friend Evil Ed is now living in
the
abandoned home
that
was Jerry's house,
yeah.
where Evil Ed tries to resurrect Jerry the vampire.
Look at Chris Sarandon.
Damn, instead of trying to retell the original movie all the time, why doesn't someone get to work on making that movie happen?
Before
Number
they all
one, alternative
are, you know,
ending.
Dead.
Oh yeah, I had to save the weirdest for last, as the planned ending for Fright Night just would have been awful, and would have really missed the mark had it not been changed, as the alternative ending would have seen Peter Vincent turn into a vampire while hosting a late night episode of Fright Night.
No.
This really does kind of go against the character's journey and development we
it
see
does.
Him go through in the
yeah.
film. So I'm glad this idea was binned. That, and it's just insanely similar to the ending of
Howling,
yep, which sees a news reporter turn into a werewolf on live TV. So people would have just assumed
ending,
that the ending was a rip-off,
right,
and thus might have not liked the movie as much, which could have affected its eventual cult status.
Status.
Yep, that one scene could have really screwed things up for Fright Night, especially considering that a movie's ending is its lasting impact that it has on its audience. Anyway, guys, I hope you enjoyed this fun and glorious, insightful exploration into Fright
well,
Night.
Thank you, Minty.
As far as classic vampire movies of the 1980s goes, Fright Night is right up there with The Lost Boys, But that's a story for another episode.
The Lost Boys.
Anyway, I'm Minty, right, and have a pleasant fright night. Did you see that? Did you see what I did there? See ya.
Goodbye. Next, we got this, a review of the Vineyard. Man versus film.
From Vinegar Syndrome comes The Vineyard.
He's got an accent,
which
funny.
Is kind of partially written, starring, and partially directed by James Hong, the man.
Yes, it is. Totally not a vanity project, right, Porky?
And Little China. This came out in the mid 80s, and this is the kind of horror movie that I just eat up. You get
all those arrow
recognizable
actor, things behind him, like all the shit behind him. So much shit.
Really good,
so much
practical
stuff. I see Evil Dead 2.
And
big.
You get enough money to make it look like a competent production, but they still have that exploitation and little low budget quirks that make it my kind of mix. We get James Hong, who's really stretching himself here. He's playing an ancient magician,
evil sorcerer,
who is trying to find a bride.
I know, it's a real stretch for James Hong. And I know, it can't live up to that. He's totally not played that before in any other movie. Right, Porky?
No, I see it.
Anyway, what does that mean, Porky? China is here.
This vineyard, which is renowned amongst the wine drinking community for creating the best wines, of course, and with great success. There must be a little bit of darkness behind all that. It turns out he's been living for centuries, and he just now at this moment is pretending to be a kind of producer, going to bring aspiring actors over to maybe star in a movie. He gets his bunch over to start with, and he is going to slowly, one by one, infect them with spells and kind of use them as his sustenance to drain their blood to keep him young at the moment, and maybe bury their bodies in the vineyard, giving that wine that extra something
other
vineyard winery can compete with. But the special effects are wonderful, and when you've got James Hong in the main role, you get this wonderfully quirky performance. He has way of using his voice and his body of
well, James Hong is a good actor,
of raising that voice up and down to create wonderful mannerisms and quirks. And you can see the fact that he's kind of wrote this and directed it, that he's kind of leaned in to it very much so by having his character quite openly caress and rub against all these young women, which
yes, totally not a vanity project
license there to do kind of stuff like that, but that's what he has done here. Like I said, the effects are wonderful. You
Thank
get
you,
one at the start as he suddenly starts to transform into something grotesque, desperate in need of his blood from the younger victims.
Yeah, the makeup on him.
You get all
was
kinds
pretty good.
Of wacky
and his
stuff.
And his mother.
Oh yeah, the makeup and pull. Really
the zombie makeup was not good.
No,
some of
no, it was not. That's not where the budget went.
No.
And his wife at the start, who he discovers is having an affair. And he makes the person, the worker that is, she's having an affair with, basically get fired. But that's not good enough. He sends his henchmen to kick the crap out of him. And then when he's beaten, bloody, a shell of a man on the floor, he demands that he is castrated before being killed. He
That does happen. It do be
and
like
you see that right from the start.
That is how the movie starts too, with the guy getting castrated after the dream. Being old,
it's just typical of these.
And getting murdered
by
his wife.
They're not the best actors. They're not the worst. They look a little bit odd in their certain roles. You've got a bookworm who looks like he works out 8 days a week, and they're just victims waiting to be picked off. Everything great about this movie revolves around James Hong and his wonderfully odd performance.
Oh, it's great. His performance in this movie is fun.
The weird gore that it goes for. The
he totally wanted to make a Big Trouble in Little China
pull
in, you know.
A needle through a neck, or whether it's
fucking
be piercing
your
jugular to get some
mission.
Blood for assistance. To see all the weird ideas of getting into this movie, it's just
corpse.
So incredibly fun. The fact that he's got this massive mansion, this island is all to himself.
Too many horror directors,
this
I remember.
Dungeon where he hangs up his victims, which literally looks like a 2 meter square room housing about 8
John
people
Carpenter.
At one point.
I don't know why it was a blank on his name. John Carpenter said, no, that movie flopped. John, all your movies have flopped, okay? Cell,
which is Assault on Precinct
13, that flopped. Halloween funny. Technically flopped,
get,
too.
A little bit of a backstory to this character. You get the addition
everything
of
he's
his
made has flopped.
Decrepit mother, who has been just decaying for
she
centuries.
Is decaying.
Who kind of bounces about this room looking to pick people off. You get the idea that this wine is almost part spell as well, in the way that it's infecting people. And as if that wasn't enough,
I mean, he worships like an Aztec god while practicing Chinese mysticism. That's a little weird.
Of this character who rise up from the grave looking to attack because they don't have that closure that they should have had in life because they were cut short by this maniacal madman. The Vineyard was awesome, terrific, fantastic.
It is a fun film.
Effects, which,
I didn't like it as much as this guy likes it.
No, this guy really loves it.
Terrific.
And I agree. I don't love it as much as he does either.
Lighting,
it's still fun, but it's
nice
not direction. This.
Yeah.
Good production standards.
This is definitely
and
someone
nice
who definitely loves the movie.
I understand what he's saying, though. It hits
yes.
all the boxes for him.
It does.
And there are movies like that that are... That I enjoy, that I know other people don't quite get.
Vineyard was a terrific blind buy and first time watch. I am going to watch this one again. I'm going to get some friends over.
That it makes total sense, though, that it was on Vinegar Syndrome.
Yeah, it does, doesn't it?
That would totally be
a thing they would buy.
A thing they would buy up, yeah.
Yes, it would.
Have you seen it? Let me know in the comment box.
And I do really appreciate Vinegar Syndrome for doing great cover work.
They do. 100%. Manhunter. Eureka's December announcement. Okay, let's move on now to someone we
actually,
know
you know
quite
what Vinegar Syndrome had released?
Mm.
Roadhouse.
Oh, yeah, they did. That's
and they
right.
have a really awesome Roadhouse cover.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, it's really great. They got their own little special features on it. It's got a real, like, cool 80s retro vibe.
Oh, nice.
With the art schemes and everything. It's great.
Oh. Yeah, I'm sure if, I'm sure, you know, people
I do believe it's
up...
limited edition.
Oh, is it? Yeah, so yeah. I'm sure people would probably want to pick that up if you're a real Roadhouse fan.
Yeah.
Let's watch Stitch together. Andy, the maniacal cinephile.
Hello, we're Andy, the maniacal cinephile, and welcome to Boots to Reboots. In today's therapy session, we're going to a dance academy.
But Andy, I've never been good at dancing.
True, we got two left feet.
That's
The original 1977 Suspiria is an Italian supernatural horror film.
As much as the Suspiria film's good, like, it is a good film, can we talk about the fact Dario Argento, just like John Carpenter, looks like a fucking corpse? And Asia's not far behind looking like a corpse, because she is. She takes after her father more than her mother.
Yeah.
And that she saw, like, a rape scene with her mother as, like, a young child, and her father's really creepy about her. What is with it?
They just released... They just released, like, the last text messages that she sent to Bourdain before he killed himself. It's pretty awful.
Yeah,
if you want to look into it.
Yeah, it's Asia. She's a fucking awful person. She's all behind that Me Too shit. She's one of the spearheads of that whole thing. And isn't it funny that she's accused of, like, you know, that kid she was babysitting saying what she wanted to do to him? That wasn't creepy at all. God almighty. Fuck
film directed by horror legend Dario Argento, who co-wrote the screenplay with then-girlfriend Daria Nicolodi. Argento was inspired by stories of her grandmother, who said she fled a German music academy because they were secretly practicing witchcraft.
Today, They call it Pilates.
The original stars Jessica Harper as a New York ballet student who transfers to a prestigious dance academy in Germany, but after a series of brutal murders, realizes the academy is a front for a coven of witches.
Yep.
Just like
also,
those Tupperware parties.
Also, it's totally not a
Jallo
film or anything,
the
but
film
it is.
Is the first of the three Mothers trilogy, including Inferno
the
and the
Inferno's
Mother of
good.
Tears. Suspiria was well received by critics for its visual and stylistic flair, use of vibrant colors, and its score by
some
Argento and the progressive
the
rock band Goblin.
Goblin.
Argento designed
Goblin's
the film to
few.
Resemble an acid
some
trip. Suspiria, which translates to sighed or whispered, is considered one of the scariest movies of all time, some calling it the closest a filmmaker has come to capturing a nightmare.
Those people Type have brand. Never seen the Canadian movie Things.
Things. Mm, God,
that's
that movie.
Human blood, all right.
Suspiria is recognized as one of the most influential films in the horror genre. So somebody decided to remake it. The 2018 remake of Suspiria is directed by Luca Guadagnino with a screenplay by David Kajanik. A remake was first announced in 2008 after Luca had acquired the rights. He offered the film to David Gordon Green, director of the new Halloween trilogy, but that project was eventually canceled.
Yep.
In 2015, Luca decided to direct, describing his version as a homage to the original rather than a straightforward remake. He stated, "It's impossible to remake Argento's film."
And
yes,
yet,
that is a thing about
here
Argento,
we are.
They can't remake
so let's cross the remake of Suspiria off the list.
And he's right.
And
it's
see
really
if it deserves
the, shit he did.
The booze.
But I still don't like Argento. He is a horrible fucking human being. I know it's one of the things that we do. From the artist, but
set during the same
people,
year the original
people.
Was made, we meet
I
dancer
like films,
Patricia Hingle, played by Chloe Grace Moretz. She reveals the school's matrons are a coven of witches to her psychotherapist, Dr. Joseph Klepperer.
And you think they can hear you? No.
Andy, there's something off about that old man.
Little buddy, that's no man. It's Tilda Swinton after they remove all the makeup.
What kind of a school is this? And where do I register?
After Pat mysteriously disappears, we meet Susie Banyan, a Mennonite girl from Ohio, played by Dakota
yes,
Johnson,
Ohio.
Known for
Yet again.
50 Shades of Grey. Susie arrives in West Berlin to audition for the Marcus Dance Company.
But you really shouldn't be here at all. Do you understand?
What I'm told, walking into Chuck E. Cheese. In the original, we see Pat attacked by Robin Williams.
By Harry Ann.
Me every year, waiting for Spirit Halloween to open. Pat is stabbed and dragged to the roof of the apartment building before being thrown through the skylight.
That's a death scene.
This kicks the original off with a bang, and the visuals are excellent. Susie befriends Sarah Sims, played by Mia Goth, while her dancing attracts attention
That's
from
Shia
artistic
LaBeouf's
director
girlfriend.
And choreographer, mm-hmm. Madame Blanc.
Interpretive dance.
Yeah.
She's good, but she's no Napoleon Dynamite.
That was tears.
During a rehearsal, Olga feels the matrons are responsible for Patricia's disappearance and accuses them of witchcraft.
Batman. I yell the same thing when I'm tossed out of the strip club.
Olga attempts to flee the school, only to become trapped in a room of mirrors. Meanwhile, Susie volunteers for the lead and performs for Madame Blanc, proving her dance moves can kill.
Magic. That was a weird death compared to the actual rhythm.
Now she's starting to look like a girl named Olga.
That happened to me at a wedding. Doing the chicken dance.
one of them contortionists,
well,
I hear.
She
now, don't
definitely
worry, the
tore something up
Porky,
on the
okay?
dance floor.
It's a political plan.
The matrons find Olga
I wonder what that's
and drag
line
her
from,
away
right,
with large meat hooks.
That is pretty brutal.
I do that with the automatic doors at the grocery store. Madame Blanc learns more about Susie. She left religion behind in Ohio and once traveled to New York to see Blanc.
Okay, I got stuff for me. Left religion behind in Ohio, then moved to godless New York. Oh.
Blanc dance.
What did it feel today to dance folk in front of the one who made it?
It felt like what I think it must feel like to fuck.
You
it
mean
feel
to
like to fuck?
I was thinking of an animal.
An
what?
Animal? Did Trent Reznor see this dance? In a flashback, we see Susie's religious mother smashing her hand with an iron after catching her flicking the bean.
Why? Push that button, and every girl prays to God.
The police come to question the matrons about Patricia's disappearance.
Dann eine Person namens Blanc?
Das bin ich.
She's Blanc. How many makeups is Tilda Swinton wearing?
Little buddy, she's lying. At the same time, Susie and Sarah are going through Pat's file, and Susie catches the matrons laughing at the police officer's nightstick. Hopefully the law doesn't hold that against them. Later, Susie is told to improvise a dance, which Marcus can feel from below. Quiet! What do I live under a dance studio? Having found their vessel, Susie becomes Blanc's protege and the lead dancer in Volk.
Volk.
Higher. Higher.
Higher to Ohio.
I've seen better dancing lessons between Warwick Davis and Johnny Depp.
Oh, God.
Fucking give me passion.
Oh, no, not that movie.
Meanwhile, Klemperer becomes suspicious of the matrons and seeks Sarah's help at a restaurant.
Thank you for caring for Patricia, but I hope you don't come again.
She stormed out because who eats dinner at 2 p.m.? At the academy, the matrons conspire against Susie while Miss Griffith checks the sharpness of a knife with her neck.
Unlike the knife, the conversation was pretty dull.
Sarah discovers a way into the inner sanctum where the coven holds their rituals. She takes one of the hooks and brings it to Klemp, who mentions a trio of witches who once roamed Earth.
Mother Tenebrarum, Mother Lacrimarum, and Mother Suspiriorum.
AKA the Mothers of Darkness, Tears, and Sighs. You know what? I'm the Mother of Hotness, Beers, and Thighs. Ew, mother, you don't even have a body. Never mind.
Not good for them to never mind.
Score! He's got a new back scratcher. In the original, Sarah discovers Pat's notes are missing, and she flees when an unseen assailant enters the room. Sarah is cornered in the attic, but escapes through a small window.
Yeah, that razor wire.
Me, trying to untangle my slinky.
Being tangled allows the killer to strike.
And that is why I stopped using a straight razor. To shave my nuts.
What in the Japanese bondage knots is this? I just got a DM from an army hammer. On the opening night of Volk, Sarah returns to the sanctum and finds Patricia, her body decayed and withered.
How producers see women over the age of 25.
Holes magically manifest in the floor as the performance begins.
Before the show, She was told to break a leg.
Sarah, discovered and healed by the matrons, emerges to dance looking like she's possessed by Pazuzu. However, yeah. It's not always fun to stay at the YMCA.
Oh, God.
And she collapses in pain. Only one thing can save this performance. The Macarena.
Like Dr. Evil.
After the performance, Susie and Blanc speak, using telepathy.
As you do, you know. Especially when you're in art school.
Choose what?
I'm confused. Is the remake
what to watch
all in
on
Italian?
Netflix? While dining out with the matrons,
actually,
all the dancers...
Because like,
I keep seeing like, subtitles
like America.
And shit.
Are they speaking... Actually, no, I think they're speaking German. What the fuck? What?
I don't know.
That's weird. Why is it that way? Maybe it's in Italian, or maybe it's something's going
sing
on.
Sing and laugh, except Blanc and Susie.
We gotta be more solid. I don't want them to know that we're thinking of.
Scared by what he saw at the academy, Klemperer disposes of the hook.
Like Austin throwing the belt off the bridge.
I'll see you a little bit later.
Oh my! There goes the belt!
No!
Klemp returns to his cottage where he finds Anka, his wife who went missing during the Holocaust. Anka is played by Jessica Harper, Susie, in the original, who came out of a 16-year retirement.
Huh.
Anka reveals that she fled and escaped. The couple walk together, but Anka disappears, and Klemp discovers that he's been led back to the academy. Hands off, ladies! He's a married man! Susie is led to the Red Room, where she finds the matrons, a whimpering Klemperer, and the bewitched dancers.
Evil.
Oh, thank God. I'm not the only one who plays Naked Twister in their basement.
Oh, no.
I'm starting to see why Marcus needs a new body.
Yeah.
Her current one is much too sexy.
In this scene, Tilda
looking
Swinton
like
plays Blanc, Klemperer, and Marcus. Like I tell Evil before dinner, would you leave some roles for the rest of us? Sarah, Patricia, and Olga are gutted, but Blanc attempts to stop the ritual and save Susie. Enraged, Marco says, look at the flick of the wrist.
Now that is a severance package!
Susie accepts her fate as Marcus's vessel, only to reveal she's the reincarnated Mother Suspiriorum?
What?
Mother Suspiriorum!
I am she.
Andy, is Susie a
That's
heel
the twist.
Or a
that
baby face?
Twist.
It's unclear, but maybe
face.
Her mother knew something was wrong.
My daughter, she's my sin. She's what I smeared on the world.
Did mommy know? Or was she crazy? Is this a Rosemary's Baby situation?
Oh, no.
Is that why little Susie was drawn to Germany?
Oh, that was
so
in Germany.
So many questions.
Ohio and New York,
Susie
Germany.
Summons Death Incarnate to cleanse the company of Marcus and her followers.
More like Beyond the Black
Death
Rainbow, though, than necessarily.
Really
yeah.
needs a breath mint.
Especially with the Panos lighting. But then again, that's in the original Suspiria, too. There it is!
What's going on in there?
50 Shades
What's
of
going
Red,
on in
Jerry!
There,
50 Shades Giddy of Red, up. Jerry!
Ew. Put that
that's
away.
The
They're
darkness
children,
inside
brother.
Me as well!
Much like the Red Sea, this sequence is choppy and nauseating.
Video films
Patricia, Olga, and Sarah die that. Peacefully at Susie's hand.
What do you ask?
I ask for my insides to be back inside.
Nope.
Meanwhile, Klemperer is released in a state of confusion. I think all of us are.
Yeah.
He acts like he's never been to a naked satanic ritual before.
Yeah, geez,
Miss Vendigast
that's normal in
then
Germany.
Discovers Blanc is alive.
What?
Tilda does have a neck like a giraffe.
Oh, God.
In the original, Susie stabs Marcus and flees the school as it implodes.
Right back,
Porky.
All right.
School's out, baby!
Dun, 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 dun. Oh, no. Keep playing it.
In the epilogue, Susie, now Mother Suspiriorum, visits Klemperer to apologize.
I regret what my daughters did to you.
Yet, I don't see a single fruit basket. She reveals that his wife, Anka, died in a concentration camp. Before leaving, Mother Suspiriorum causes him to have a seizure, erasing his memories.
Could she erase my memories of Tilda Swinton's saggy sack?
While the original Suspiria was Argento's highest grossing film in the United States, the remake made only $7.6 million
only
worldwide.
Oh,
according
that's
to Luca,
not a good sign, then.
It made absolutely nothing. It was a disaster at the box office. The screenwriter admitted to not being a fan of the original film, so he took a more practical approach, doing a lot of research on witchcraft, the time period, and feminist politics.
Oh, yeah.
It's about equality and being pretentious.
The writer chose to set the film in 1977, the year the original film was released, during the series of terrorist events known as the German Autumn.
Oh, no.
The film tries to explore themes of generational guilt in Germany with this historical backdrop, but it doesn't quite connect. The focus should have been on the themes of motherhood with Blanc versus Susie's mother and that perversion of power.
Perversion.
Like, why do I have to go to bed? It's still light out.
Although the original is set at a dance academy, there's very little dancing. In the remake, I like the idea of the witches using dance to transmit spells. They're able to hide in plain sight and influence the public without them knowing it. The stylized dance sequences are one of the highlights of the movie. They were all professional dancers,
yep,
except for Dakota Johnson and Mia Goth, who trained 8 hours a day for 8 weeks. The remake score was composed by Radiohead singer Tom York, his first feature film score. It's effective,
none of his solo
but
stuff
didn't really
good.
Leave
no,
a lasting impression. Most film scores wouldn't, compared to the original's beautiful and haunting music.
Well, it's Goblin. You can't really compete with Goblin.
Yeah.
Those are the most whimsical sliding doors I've ever heard. The effects were done by makeup artist Mark Coulier, who previously worked on Clive Barker's
Nightbreed
and Candyman adaptations.
Oh, nice.
Most of the gore effects were practical, and they did a fantastic job. Olga's death scene being the highlight. However, Tilda in old man makeup was a bit distracting. It's great that Tilda had so much to do, but Chloe Grace Moretz is wasted.
Yeah.
It's time for a Hit Girl movie.
Oh, God.
Everything about the original is loud. Look at that wallpaper!
Yeah.
However, unlike the original, which used lavish colors, Luca conceived the visuals in Suspiria as winterish and bleak. I miss the look, but how hard can you rip on a movie for not using gels? The remake of Suspiria does have some interesting visuals and is well acted and choreographed. The set design was beautiful,
but
the story was
them.
Unfulfilling.
Yeah.
It's too well crafted to brush off, but too bloated to enjoy. The remake is an hour longer than the original and feels it. All the German autumn and Klempner
stuff. So like an hour and 30 to
could
then the next,
easily
and then
be cut.
Two hour
like a throat
yep.
in a Giallo movie.
I think so.
The remake definitely is not for everyone and has issues with the plot, pacing and
yeah.
runtime. However, there is enough here that makes it worth a watch. The reboot of Suspiria follows my reboot rule. Take the one sentence synopsis of the original, girl goes to school run by witches, and do something new with it. Therefore, the remake of Suspiria
2 hours 32, yep.
Jesus.
Is safe.
It doesn't get the boot.
Well, okay.
It feels his rule, so
we've been
Andy,
the maniacal cinephile.
It's okay. Again, it's not the best. You can't
we'll see you next time.
So. For 2018, I don't think it's too woke. Actually, I think it's anti-woke. That's the problem with it. And let's move on to Enough with the Remakes by Minty.
You know, the older I get, the more
not
I've come
Minty.
To realize how fucking
Minty.
Lucky
Drinker.
I was to grow up in the 1990s. It was a simpler, more optimistic, more innocent decade when movies were still awesome, Britannia was still cool, people
no.
didn't get fucking offended by
Britannia
everything.
Will never be cool,
Lara
Minty.
Croft was an awesome ass-kicking adventurer cool. with a fantastic pair of... guns instead of a...
Look, I'm sorry. They both wear sunglasses and have funny accents that are English, but not English. It's hard, okay?
Miserable waste of polygons that constantly apologizes for existing.
Gross.
It was a time when going online was a once-a-week treat
CDC.
That cost £10 an hour and required a trip to a special cafe instead of an all-consuming dystopian nightmare where people spend millions of man-hours arguing with 12-year-old edgelords on the other side of the world.
Hey,
it was also the era of the Disney Renaissance, a roughly 10-year period of unbridled creativity and commercial success when Disney's animation studios cranked out classic movies like Beauty and the Beast, The Little Mermaid, Pocahontas, The Lion King, Hercules, Mulan, and Tarzan. They were fun, exciting, heartwarming adventures that dealt with timeless themes and ideas, and if you were a young kid in the mid-90s like me, then I can pretty much guarantee you knew the soundtracks to these films off by heart. Truly,
some,
it seemed like Disney could do no wrong.
Aladdin, for sure.
Aladdin, 100%. Yeah.
Oh, how times have changed. The wide-eyed kids of the 90s are now cynical 30-somethings weighed down by the responsibilities of adult life, probably with asshole kids of their own, and quietly pining for the simple, carefree days of their childhoods. Meanwhile, the once family-friendly and patriotic Disney has mutated into a horrifyingly monstrous parody of its former self,
yep.
an insatiable, franchise-gobbling monster relentlessly consuming good ideas and beloved characters to churn out an endless conveyor belt of bland, mediocre sludge.
Mm-hmm.
And since original creative thinking is for them what innovation and risk-taking is for NASA, it was only natural that they'd inevitably turn their eyes towards the past instead of the future. And truly, what better past to pilfer than the golden age of animated movies?
Yep.
I mean, they certainly got off to a strong start with Beauty and the Beast,
did
a live-action remake of the 1991 original,
yeah.
which basically replicated the entire movie shot
still
for shot.
Ron Perlman's
sure,
Beast.
You could probably argue how lazy it was to basically make the same exact film again and sell it to a whole new generation, but who the fuck cares? Disney certainly didn't, especially when it made a shit zillion dollars for them. Talk about money for old rope. Why take the chance on new, unproven
ideas
when you can basically dust off old scripts and sell people's childhoods back to them at an inflated price? The floodgates were well and truly open, and before you knew it, we were getting bombarded with modern-day remakes of classic animated movies. The only problem is that with each new installment, they got progressively more shit. But hey, they made the company shit tons of money, so who cares? Well, all of that changed with
the
release of Mulan a couple of years ago.
I agree.
A film that went wrong in basically every way possible.
Look, Chinese
propaganda. For a start, it released in the middle of a global pandemic, when the prospect of going to the cinema was about as appealing as a colonic irrigation using habanero chilies.
Poor Donnie Yen.
Attempts to pander to the Chinese market backfired spectacularly
yes,
since it,
did. It
fucked up most aspects of Chinese culture and
Thank
history.
God.
And for rather obvious reasons, Western audiences weren't exactly thrilled by all things Chinese at that time either.
Mm-hmm.
As a result, the film bombed, and it wasn't the only one.
Porky, why do you think that is? Why do you think that we weren't happy with the Chinese?
Because they were filming around like where the Uyghurs were?
Yes, well, there's that. But what's the biggest reason why we wouldn't like the Chinese at that time? Could it be could it be a cough of some kind that's all their fault because they're horrible, filthy bug people? Yes, it is.
Want to attract negative attention. The first teaser trailer for the upcoming remake of The Little Mermaid has got one of the most brutal YouTube ratios since Frosk decided to publicly torpedo her own company live on air. And to be honest, it's not entirely hard to see why, because this movie basically exemplifies everything that's bad about these fucking remakes. And no, I'm not talking about the fact that the actor playing a mythical sea monster has got slightly different melanin levels in her skin. Disney baited the fans with that one because they knew they could use the resulting backlash to silence any actual criticism of the movie, and they fell for it, hook, line, and sinker. Okay, that's enough nautical references for now. The bigger issues are more fundamental ones that you can apply to basically all of the Disney remake movies. I mean, for a start, take a look at the color palette of this thing. Gross. Look how dark and muted and subdued everything is, and then compare it to the original animated movie. You see how much more bright and vibrant and interesting that world looks? Yeah, it's completely unrealistic that the deep ocean would look this way, but it doesn't really matter, because it's an animated movie with its own visual style, and that style allows the artist to set their own rules for how you engage with it as the audience.
That's exactly what you should do with a children's cartoon.
But the moment you bring live action into the equation, you immediately constrain yourself with the limitations of what people expect
to see
in the real world.
That
means the deep ocean is now a dark and foreboding place, where Ariel is framed like some kind of terrifying monster, instead of a plucky heroine longing to experience the world above. Jesus, if you swap out the soundtrack for a horror theme, the face reveal feels like it should be more like this.
Yeah.
This particular problem was especially noticeable in The Lion King, where the animators had been given the almost impossible task of humanizing the animal characters while also keeping them looking photorealistic. And the results were...
Nightmarish.
Take a look at the original movie. You see how expressive and compelling the performances are? Yeah, obviously real animals can't
real
move, talk, and gesticulate anything like this, but it doesn't matter because just like
it's
the Little Mermaid movie, it's an animated film with its own rules about how these things work, so it becomes very easy to suspend your disbelief. Supposedly realistic CGI, on the other hand, doesn't have that luxury.
Creepy.
And Jesus Christ, don't even get me started about Will Smith.
Oh my lord, look at him. Look at him. It's so bad. Did you think to yourself, oh no, wait, I can make something worse than Hancock. I can make something worse than Wild Wild West. I know what I can do. I know what I can do. I can beat this. And then I can slap someone on stage for making a joke at my wife's expense.
God, I miss traditional cell animation. We're intensive, and I know it can't deliver anything like the detail you get in Pixar movies, but holy shit, there's just something so much more satisfying about it. Knowing that actual artists had to draw and animate this stuff frame by frame, instead of pre-built character models running a series of programmed movements, is just so much more human and charming. Every fucking Pixar movie nowadays looks exactly like the one that came before it. They all have the same bland, generic, soulless look about them, like you're eating a meal made from the same basic ingredients, only arranged in a slightly different way. I mean, would it kill movie studios to release the occasional film using traditional animation for once? Another issue that's been coming up more and more with these remakes is the alteration of characters and storylines to appeal to modern audiences. It started out with little things, like Emma Watson insisting that Belle be an inventor and engineer in Beauty and the Beast, because I guess being a fun-loving, intelligent young woman desperate to get out into the wider world and escaping vicariously through the medium of books just wasn't enough for her. She had to make her into Elon fucking Musk as well. Yeah. But whatever, it was just a minor change that didn't matter that much in the grand scheme of things. But what it did do was set the precedent. The problems, however, became more severe in Mulan, which basically reworked the protagonist's entire character arc to pander to the insufferable modern convention that female characters have to be fundamentally great at everything right off the bat. No inspiring lessons about the value of hard work and perseverance here.
Nope.
It was all about appealing to female empowerment in the laziest, most superficial way possible.
From a fucking society, the Chinese, by the way, that don't like that shit. They hate that.
Whoa. Speaking of which, here's a little hint from a January 2022 interview with...
Oh my god, look at her face. Look at how wide her forehead, like her fucking brow ridge is. It looks bad.
She should be a hammerhead.
She should be a hammerhead shark. She looks like Anya Taylor-Joy.
With star Halle Bailey about the direction The Little Mermaid is going to take.
You leave Anya out of this.
Oh, sorry, did you get off to Sid from Ice Age?
You leave her out of this. You leave that big booty Latina out of this, okay?
Yes, because she's Argentinian. Also yeah. Italian. Why she got a
hey,
Sid?
Attack Brittany Venti all you want. Just leave.
I think everyone will be pleasantly surprised
oh,
by some updates
famous?
Of the themes of the film. More so
no.
on Ariel's side of
cause
women.
You look
she's
at
hot.
Her body. It's because you look at her body and not
because she's
face,
hot.
Don't? Just her body.
Anya, if you ever skip to this.
Oh my god.
This is YouTube
Anya, he wants an OnlyFans
is
what I'm hearing.
Hey,
so
sup,
go ahead
girl?
And make it.
Sup.
Sup. Yeah. Not happening, Porky. Pick a lower your standards. And that I mean that's already bad because Anya Taylor does not look attractive.
Whoa,
face.
Whoa, 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 whoa. Whoa. Bro. Cool it. Cool it.
Go ahead, pitch your idea to her. Go ahead. She'll totally listen to this.
A vanity project starring me. Okay.
Yes. We're going to call it the Vineyard 2.
You're going to have to do a little nudity. I'm sorry. It's the way it's got to be. Just email me or whatever if you want to read the script.
Send nudes is what you're asking for.
An empowerment and her taking her power back. I mean, I thought the original
nice
Ariel
again,
was pretty empowered
like
already, considering she saves Prince Eric's life on more than one occasion,
she
and
does.
Her decisions
the
drive
original,
the entire course
kind
of the story, but whatever. I guess because she occasionally needs help from other people, she's just not modern enough. Can't wait for Eric to be transformed into the same useless, bumbling buffoon template that Disney used for every single male character in their movies these days, and Ariel to be an unstoppable, kick-ass girl boss who fixes everything all by herself. Modern writing, everyone. Fuck knows what it must be like to be a little boy growing up
gross.
In the 2020s. The sad thing, though, is that actresses like Halle Bailey are going to get unfairly caught up in the crossfire here. I mean, I'm sure she's a perfectly nice person that'll do a great job with the role, but none of
wait,
that really matters because all people are talking...
Bailey?
Halle Bailey, I think, or something?
Halle
Bailey? It's almost like Halle Berry, which
yeah,
is really...
Yeah, it's like a scuffed...
And she looks like a scuffed... She does look like a scuffed version of her, too. So it fits. Halle Berry.
How does she keep the wig on underwater?
I don't know how they keep the weaves on underwater.
Isn't that like a black woman thing that wear the wigs?
Yes.
Talking about now
like,
is the backlash against
her
casting.
Where do you get the wig as a mermaid?
And for what?
It's weird. I don't know how
if the real objective here was to create more lead roles for diverse actors, which is absolutely a good thing, then why not come up with new stories specifically for them instead of deliberately stirring up controversy by crowbarring them into stories that have already been told? There's an entire world of rich cultural traditions, legends, and folklore from every conceivable country, race, and creed just waiting for you to try out.
Did you ever think about that one?
Why can't we tread in the same ground over and over again? Why keep retelling stories that have already been told far better by previous generations?
Maybe it's because of the supremacy of
the money.
European culture. I'm you know, maybe, I don't know.
Oh yeah, of course. And I guess that's what this really comes down to. A quick, easy, and reliable way of making money that requires minimal...
I'm actually surprised there hasn't been a Hercules remake yet. I'll be honest. I'm surprised that hasn't happened.
Well, I mean, The Rock did his Hercules, and it was kind of a flop.
It was.
It wasn't a Disney Hercules.
No, it's the actual story of Hercules,
the
mythology thing, yeah. I'm surprised that they didn't redo the fucking animated thing. And if they do, it's going to be so bad.
Investment of risk or creative energy.
Never
do it's
that.
It's the same
Disney,
reason that Lucasfilm keeps digging at the hollowed out core of Star Wars. Why Paramount subjects us to endless Star Trek prequels. Why Amazon are trying to launch their very own Game of Thrones using Tolkien's legacy as a $1 billion canvas to finger paint on. And it all just feels so hollow and meaningless.
Them rings, Porky,
like
them
these
rings.
Stories were generated
oh, Lord,
by some
rings.
AI in a lab
them
somewhere in order to generate the highest return possible on investments.
Oh, Lord,
I mean, I'm under no illusions that big movie studios
Black
were
Dwarf.
Ever particularly invested in artistic expression, but holy shit, there was at least a pretense of trying to tell a worthwhile story along the way. The movies of the Disney Renaissance are so fondly remembered now because they struck the perfect balance between timeless ideas, likable characters, contemporary humor, creative talent, and vibrant color.
Hercules?
James Wood.
Yeah.
Yes, he did.
did a very good job.
Animation, they sold themselves on their own merits instead of resorting to member berries or cheap manufactured controversy to drum up interest.
And as a result,
they had to be really fucking good in order to work. And that's the problem. What we're producing now,
I mean, the Aladdin guy's probably second. I don't remember Mustafar or whatever.
Jafar. Jafar is voiced by a guy who's native to Ohio.
Oh. Reheated in a microwave and plonked on your plate.
Yep.
But drinker, you magnanimous maestro of media mastication, I
hear don't remember
you say,
anything about
why worry about this stuff when the original
the
movies are always
going
to exist?
That
no
is
matter
the
how
priest.
Bad things get now,
he's
we can
one
always
one
fire up
the
classic
Esmeralda.
Originals
the
and make sure that the next generation gets to enjoy the kind of timeless entertainment we did.
The Pocahontas bad guy is people that are...
the mob or something, right?
Yes, it's the person that is with John Smith, more English people. If you remember The Road to El Dorado, the bad guy is both Cortez and the Aztec who turns on them. The bad guy in Beauty and the Beast, obviously Gaston, one of the best bad guys in film, too.
Yep.
Let's see. Most Disney movies. Mulan is fucking Genghis Khan. So that's hard to forget. I'm trying to think what else. Ariel's Ursula, she's one of the best female bad guys.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Visually, she's one of the best. Very good.
Because kids. Oh, you sweet summer child, you. The problem is that fewer and fewer people bother to invest in physical media these days.
The female bad guy very well,
too. Because I guess the effort of heaving their fat, sweaty arses off the couch and shove...
The old ones, too, like you get fucking Maleficent, which is the bad guy from Sleeping Beauty. Not Sleeping Beauty, fuck. What's the one? It's not Sleeping Beauty, it's a different one.
When a disc into a player, it's just too big of a time sink in their busy lives. Instead, they resort to doing what pretty much everyone else does these days, and download their movies from a streaming service. But the big problem with digital media is that you don't really own the thing that you're watching. All you've got is a license to download the source file, and if that source file should ever be removed or... altered, well, then you're shit out of luck.
That's
we've already
right.
seen the little edits and tweaks that companies have started making to older movies that are now considered problematic. How long do you really think it's going to be before it starts happening
hunter.
To newer stuff?
Who is
movies that contain scenes or depictions or story beats
him.
That someone
Actually, no,
somewhere in some miserable corner
of
Twitter finds offensive, characters that don't quite align with the rules of modern writing, storylines
that
go against the message. The fact is, the past is no longer sacred, and it definitely isn't safe. Because there are fewer and fewer people who care about preserving it, it's more vulnerable than ever to
the
insidious, grasping manipulations of the present. Little by little, scene by scene, movie by movie, the stories that once captivated and inspired us are being quietly removed and supplanted by cheap, cynical, soulless reproductions. And if we're not careful, if we don't push back against this shit while there's still time, then we may just find ourselves in a world where there's nothing left to protect. Anyway, that's all I've got for today.
I remember other things.
Go away now.
It is Sleeping Beauty, huh? What am I thinking of? I thought another one was Sleeping
Beauty. In this day and age, we're no strangers to capitalizing on franchises.
So let's talk about remakes. What are they talking about, Porky? Are they talking about Slumber Party Massacre, the remake?
Oh, no.
Gotta remind someone of their sins.
People love and adore over the years, but the general public probably doesn't know Slumber Party Massacre, so I feel like this is a really strange movie for sci-fi to remake. But here we are. We've got the Banana Splits director on board and a young cast ready to get drilled.
Guess it's time to start the Slumber Party!
So now they've changed from Bloodbath and Beyond, Porky, to Bloodbath TV. They rebranded. Look at them.
A new movie, we are going to be spoiling it and talking about it. So this movie basically kicks off with a false start. We have a group of women at a cottage and they are stalked and killed by Russ Thorne, a maniac with a massive drill. And one of them lives to tell the story. Fast forward several years later, her daughter is now going camping right across the
I saw an amazing video on TikTok
where she was almost murdered because
where a guy has a big drill like that, like a 5-foot long drill
with her friends on Russ Thorne.
And he takes a 2x4 and he puts the drill drill in the end.
We are going to kill him.
This
and he drills a hole through the 2x4 without popping out of any of the sides.
Damn.
Without the drill bit, like, puts the whole thing like 5 feet in there.
What's interesting about Slumber Party Massacre in general is at the core a feminist horror movie. The original, it's a classic. It's written and directed by women. The drill represents the masculinity of the killer. All of the women are strong. They're powerful. They take down Russ Thorne and basically destroy him at the end of the day.
In the original, it was symbolism. In this film, it was throwing in your face.
Guys, I think the ladies know what they're talking about, right?
Yeah, totally.
So apparently they just said the original movie is supposed to be a feminist thing too, even though it's not.
Yeah, I mean, you could interpret it that way if you want.
Yeah, apparently.
Do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But it's so not...
No, it's not. It's
to the forefront. It's so in the background that
yes.
you kind of have to see it. Like you have to see that you're for yourself. You can't you can't really put that on the movie and make everyone know that. Like you can't just go like that's what it is.
Before we move on, this is a great shot. That's and it doesn't show it on OBS, but on fucking my end, where it shows it, where I'm going through Watch Together. I see this. And this is great. Bros Before Hoes, the shirt this guy is wearing.
Oh.
So,
that's funny.
I'm going to post that in general.
See, and that's actually pretty funny.
It is.
Like,
there are instances in this
movie. There are instances of, like, good gore and good humor.
Mm-hmm.
But it's all, like, set up with just, like, obnoxious, like,
very
in your face, like, messaging.
Yes. I agree 100%. Very obnoxious.
Yeah, let's listen to the ladies. Then he rolls up his sweatshirt, Bros Before Hoes. It's funny. That's funny.
Mm-hmm. It is.
It's too bad that they don't put more emphasis on that kind of stuff.
Yeah, they didn't, and that was a shame. I mean, there's interesting stuff of dynamics and things they tried to do, but because they're trying to push some kind of stupid shit, it doesn't really work.
Yeah.
Yeah, let's keep
Who ends up being in the house across the pond, which was the original cabin, was a bunch of guys who are in slow motion, getting topless, trying to rip pillows, which I think is absolutely hilarious.
Or like we have like the slowly shot seductive shower scene. I was loving all that role reversal. They're doing all the tropes, but acknowledging it in the film. That's where I have the problem, where they actually blatantly call it out.
Why?
Because then it's like you're explaining the joke.
Why are you
gay? Explain it. It's not funny.
I can finally get rid of these. Playing the hot girl is exhausting.
It looked great. There's some great kills with a drill. Russ Thorne is fucking awesome. We'll get to him. But there's literally a moment where, like, Dana, our main lead, calls this out.
Like, even when she's facing off with, I believe it was John near the end of the film.
This is part of your big feminist plot to get rid of all the men.
That was a really sexist thing to say.
I get what it looks like. The issues aren't in the women being super powerful. We always root for that. That's what makes Final Girl.
Do we? Do we always root for that?
Do we root for the women to be super powerful? No.
No.
I think you just put women in situations and then you have them work themselves out of them in a practical way. And 100%. People go, wow, that's cool.
Yeah, it's cool to see, like, someone survive a killer and outsmart them.
I don't think, like, you watch Alien and you go, like,
no.
Oh, I want this woman to be super powerful. You're just like, no, you just want them to survive.
Yeah, you want someone to survive and it ends up being a woman at the end. That's fine. Ripley was shown to be smart. She was shown to be ahead of everybody else trying to figure out what was going on. And she does, and then she ends up injuring the fucking guy who's the droid and finding out the information from him, and then everyone else gets on board, but she can't save everybody else, and they make mistakes, as humans do. I mean, she almost gets killed herself several times, too.
I mean, it's partly by chance, but it's partly because of her own actions.
Yes, exactly.
And that's why you have other people who make bad decisions and get killed.
Yes, exactly.
Final Girl's important in horror movies, and I think Dana was fucking awesome as a Final Girl. However, to just stop what you're doing and say the line.
We are these smart, tough, incredible, kick-ass women.
It's like even the moment where Ashley is.
I was
kind of
hoping the outcast girl would be the Final Girl.
Of course, they have to say
it's a good thing you know how to fix cars.
Just let her go fix the car. You don't have to be like, oh, I'm glad you know how to fix the car.
I know what
I'm doing. Yeah, you do.
even the references to the original franchise. I was honestly like, I had my head in my hand. I'm like, okay, you're showing the guitar from 2. Everybody's gonna know because it looks like the guitar. But then it's like,
where'd you get that, Sean?
I found it in the closet. Sick, right?
Oh, yeah.
And even use it as a primary prop for the movie. There are moments where it is done really well.
It
like
looked
the
like a
space
cheap
baby
copy
shirt.
Of
I think
it,
that's
it
a
does
really
when they
great
show the original.
That
no,
isn't
very
too
cheap
in
copy
your face, yeah, and only shown briefly in the original.
Even having the replica of like the Hunky Boys magazine.
But like they have these little subtleties. It even is like the same shot of the girls on the couch. Also the reverse shot of Russ with the drill.
I will say, because we've been pretty negative right now, I am going to talk about some things that I did like about the humor and how the film was done. Because going back to role reversal, the moment where the mechanic is like fixing the car.
You're not going to make it tonight.
What about now?
I don't see how that's going to help.
He has a point.
I laughed so hard because they didn't be like, he's a mechanic.
Early on in the movie, you get that joke.
Mm-hmm.
And you're like, okay, this could be fun. Mm-hmm. And then, but no.
That's how I think you would react if you saw titties and someone said, hey, can you fix my car? I don't see how that's going to help.
Yeah. It's like the part has to get here and then it's like time consuming to fix.
Your boobs to fix stuff. The fact that they mention it, that's what made this joke great.
Do your boobs warp time and space?
Even the guy one, guy two bit.
And I found guy dead in the cooler.
Guy died in the house.
No, that was the other guy. There were two of them.
I'm a sucker for Abbott and Costello, and this is your classic
who got a little
first.
I thought that was even more shitty than the rest of it.
Guy one, guy two.
It was funny, pretty funny in that scene.
Guy two is...
But then,
I think the writing just sucked across the board, personally.
Especially when they were trying to, like, have their reveals. Even in our false start.
So, did you ever figure out who he cheated with?
No.
Well, maybe he had a good reason for doing it.
Meanwhile, one of the girls says something about the ex-boyfriend. Can't control her eating and then start vomiting. You're like, yeah, I get it. She slept with him. She's pregnant with his kid now. And then when they reveal it, it's like, yeah, you didn't need to say it.
I slept with Jack.
Or when like the mom is like, be safe, be safe. And then like they hang on that shot of her hand in the air with like the dun dun dun. Like we're supposed to not know that that was the mom. The biggest twist of this film is when they have Kay revealed as the killer. It was so obvious.
Oh, you don't want to stay here.
We don't really have a choice.
Unless you know of someplace else we can stay around here.
Oh, it's available.
I mean, she wasn't the first to
What
just
a surprise.
Come to this house. I'll drop you off. Here's the Wi-Fi that I control. Here's the cookies.
Kay left them at the door for us.
She's lucky Russ didn't murder her when she dropped them off.
And you're like, yeah, Kay is the killer. How she was tied in, you're like, I don't know. Is she like sister, like mother?
Mom.
It was a little bit of a stretch. The age between Russ and Kay looked a little too close to be mother-son.
What are you doing out here?
Snail.
I don't know about that.
I think
she
Russ
could be...
nailed exactly.
Oh, young
she could
mother,
be 70.
I can see that. Yeah.
And he could be like 50.
Yeah, I could see that.
That's, 20
the
year
Russ
difference is all you really need,
original.
18 year difference.
I love you.
The way that he delivered his lines and his weird facial expressions while holding up the drill was perfect.
And then
we're not
they
trying to completely
off.
Knock this movie. I think they cast did an excellent
an
job.
Hour.
Everybody played their parts pretty well.
That part,
although
them,
I did still
their
hate
little
the
thing.
Sister.
There was like
I think
a
that's
lesbian
just
thing
a
going
trend
on.
In Slumber Party Massacre movies, hate the sister.
I can still hear you.
Dana knocked it out of the park as like
Wait,
our
that
main
was a little
lead.
Sister?
I think she was.
She was a little sister, yes, of that one chick.
Who's a little sister?
The
no.
fucking. Yeah, she is. She's her little sister. She's her younger sister.
They don't look.
No, they don't.
Enough like.
No,
they don't.
They don't.
Even really establish.
No.
Okay.
Badass. I think all the girls were badass, and I liked that they actually had weapons. They had a plan. Everything just
that
made
like
sense.
That seems like something crazy
as, like,
people would
what
do.
Their
Who
goal
the fuck
was.
Thinks that?
There's 3 of us.
Yeah.
We outnumber him.
There's 8 of us.
So if no one's ever seen a Slumber Party Massacre, they're coming into this for the first time, and they're seeing these fun, playful characters who are also really bad.
I don't know about that. I think you'd want to see the original before you watch this.
Oh, yeah.
Literally really badass in a even very over-the-top killer. And the kills were good.
Again, he's absolutely a great killer, loved the kills. The production value.
Oh, that fucking thing, that face kill
actors
is great.
Involved.
If they could have just
the director, Dinesh,
remade the
did
first
a great
movie
job, mm-hmm. and Susan
with
Kelly,
this
who
guy
it,
as the
also
killer,
wrote yes. Leprechaun
they could have had a
where
hit.
The jokes weren't as evident.
Which is funny because some of the tropes in that film reoccur in this film.
Yeah, which is totally cool. It's just done better.
When they did it in Returns, they were doing it to develop characters. Like, a woman who's handy, it was not as like a, hey, women can do this too. This was like, this is her character. In this one, it was a blatant shot at women can do what men can do.
I don't hate it, but I didn't love it. This was middle of the road for me. I think this is gonna be a better watch for people who aren't huge fans of the franchise. There are some things for fans of the franchise, but I think they're too in your face. And ironically, the women seem weaker when they need to call out how strong they are. But I think still worth watching, but it's not a hard recommend. So I'm going to give this 2.5 wooden barrel dick boys out of 5.
Fucking scene.
This should come as no surprise. Like I said earlier, it was a love-hate relationship with this film. I right, did like a lot of it. But there's
yeah,
also
you
stuff
really
that
liked the
I was
shower
irritated
scene.
With. It was too in your face. They had to explain all their jokes, that. And it was a lot more fun in moments in the film when they let the scenes play out. I thought all of our actors did a fantastic job. The cast was great. We didn't mention this. The score was fantastic too. It was awesome.
The score was actually pretty good.
It's a fun time, but not a great time. So with that being said, I'm gonna
give
this
film
2.5 untitled goose lamps out of 5.
As always, thank you for watching. Like this video and comment below with your thoughts on the film if you've seen it. If you haven't and you do want to check it out, links are in the description. Nope. But also check out our review of the first movie. I think it's better. 100%
better. 100% better.
Our review is
it's one of my all-time favorites. It's a real quick watch.
Because we're not complete assholes. Yes. And subscribe to our channel for less asshole-ish reviews. Or maybe more. When it comes to Squatch territory, we get kind of vicious.
I don't know if you got that vicious. Okay. Alright, Porky, time for pain to end up on. Tonight, last video.
Part 2 of my foray into Hulk, and I'm on camera now. I was in Florida, away from all my camera equipment,
uh-oh.
So I couldn't film myself.
She
but
was.
Now
she's not
in
A-note more.
Chicago,
she's in Chicago
again,
better.
And I'm doubling up on episodes. I'm reacting to episode 2 and 3
yes, I can
because
hear you.
Episode
okay.
2 was.
Did your net get up there for a bit?
The video's choppy.
Oh, is it choppy for you? That's weird.
Yeah.
Huh.
It's just such a nothing. It was, yeah, it's a nothing. But I've stated this
nothing.
Before, that Phase 4 shows are basically just 6 to 8 hour films cut up into episodes of
that's
television.
Disgusting.
Which makes some
that's
episodes
disgusting,
feel very empty
feel
and worthless. Because usually that's the downtime of the film where you can just go take a shit and come back later and you wouldn't have missed anything. Let's get it on. A little bit more.
It's true. I am a Hulk.
That eye twitch. I'm
it's
just
true. I'm
that
a Hulk.
Eye twitch right there.
What look at that eye.
Happened to me.
Previously on.
I'm sorry.
No. You know what I hate about television is the previously on sections, especially when the show isn't really that complicated. This isn't some kind of complex show where I need to be reminded, like, oh, where were the intricate plots? You know that I may have missed. It's just an MCU show. We know what happened in the last episode. We know
nothing.
And the whole streaming service thing doesn't kind of render the whole previously on thing completely meaningless.
Yes,
like,
it does.
You just go back and watch the episode. It's only going to take 25 fucking minutes. Oh, skip. Skip.
Awful.
Skip.
We're super-powered influencer Titania.
Super influence.
Super-powered influencer.
Oh, y'all testing my fucking patience. They think they're so clever that somehow they can do the RoboCop satire thing. Now I gotta put my glasses on to read the shit. Titania's lawyers say entire incident was an unfortunate misunderstanding and the result of extreme case of low blood sugar.
What?
Turn into a Hulk. Like a chick Hulk.
A chick Hulk.
Exactly.
I was hoping that they would cut out the black dude and replace him. Like, there's some crazy cat lady. I love it. This show is all about being progressive, but then they put in, like, the stereotypical overexcited black guy talks to the news guy trope.
That's for you.
No.
Why are they, like, chanting it? That's some autism.
That's for somebody called She-Hulk, which can't possibly be what they're calling me.
I mean, it's better than Bitch Hulk. So wait a minute, you're telling me... She had a hoodie that was like 6 feet long.
Oh my god.
Like, as far as when she went in, she was wearing like a hoodie and it was kind of baggy. Now she's She-Hulk and it's like basically a dress. Like, I would love to have seen a wide shot of her in that fucking hoodie. It would all goes all the way down her fucking ankles.
It's so dumb. I can't even exist without being a derivative of the Hulk.
Literally.
Well, you are.
Quite
what do you want?
Literally. Are. You literally have this man's blood inside of you.
Yes.
Neat little trick you pulled there, Walters. But don't you think it's a little unsportsmanlike to suddenly debut superpowers just to drum up publicity for yourself?
Only you would think that.
And that's really stupid. That's
that
very,
really
very,
dumb.
A very, very stupid
I don't know, I think,
thing to think for anybody, even like this character. Like, someone busted into a
was
court.
That Porky?
I don't know. I almost thought, like, well, I think multiple people would think that. I mean, it might be a stupid thing to think, but there actually are a lot of stupid people, so.
Well, there are a lot of stupid people. There are really, really dumb people out there. And you know what I know the dumbest people of them all? The people that wrote this shit.
Yeah.
Because they're the same people that wrote, hey, I'm Pickle Rick!
Room and tried to kill people. And she had superpowers, so she used them to the best of her ability to save the day. You want me to think this character's dumb. Okay, but, like, you can't be this dumb and be a lawyer. She looks like green Michael Jackson right
now. She does? What is that?
Take a lap, Dennis.
Yeah, come on, Dennis.
There's a hot chick over there. I'm going to go talk to it.
Oh, my God. It's like American Psycho, but for retards.
Nobody says that.
So you could be an Avenger.
That's unnatural.
Do the Avengers offer health care?
Misogynists don't even say that.
Maternity leave, a pension. Are they even paid?
Shut the fuck up! On the maternity leave tip, I mean, considering one of them created their children with magic, and the other had their insides forcibly scooped out. I'm thinking probably not.
Probably
what kills me is if you even try to criticize this shit, like, well, why won't you pay respect to the serious issues that your franchise brought up? The fucking consumers will immediately, well, it's a fucking comedy. And my rebuttal would be, you can still have a comedy and not write your show like the previous 10 years didn't matter.
Here's the thing, though. Hulk Jen is a total snack.
Yeah, like the celery stick that falls underneath your refrigerator for 2 weeks.
We didn't win the case. Since you saved the lives of the entire jury today,
don't
GLK and H argued
like
that the jury was then biased
you look
in your
gross
favor. Jenna,
you
I'm sorry.
CGI
I have to let you go.
That's bullshit. Why not tell her to recuse herself? That is a thing, right? For lawyers? Why not just switch lawyers? Well, you tainted it. People
oh, yes,
kind of like you now more. Yeah, we're firing you. You're just too awesome. We have to fire you. There might be a certain bias against the other person because
oh
you
God,
saved
Porky
people.
Isn't I just saw an ad and watched together about
to
Disney
to look
Dreamer
more
Academy.
Virtuous
what the
fuck?
Oh, no.
Law firms, aren't they all about like winning ratios? They don't really give a shit who you defend as long as you win.
Yeah,
so
they don't
like,
give a shit. That's not how lawyering works.
But that doesn't
win
make
your
sense
fucking case.
We can't hire a lawyer who's such a big distraction in court.
Actually, I wouldn't hire her if she had that cheesy
what
grin on her face
she's
either.
She's big.
What the fuck? Like, we're not hiring you. You seem like you're mentally ill.
Hiya, sweetheart.
Oh, you worthless piece of garbage. Come here.
You don't have to worry about getting fired. I already told everyone, so it won't be awkward. No one's
it
going to bring
be
it up.
Awkward.
You're gonna fire him. Chad.
Hey, what do you want me to do? I'm a male character on an MCU property. Look at my stupid hair.
Back to Hawkeye. It's pretty hazardous. Believe
oh, yeah. Don't you just hate people who love you?
God. What a bitch.
We'll be sitting around like in a vegetative, angry
the left
state
is so anti-family.
It is, 100%.
It's so weird.
Which is the funniest thing because, you know, Jen has a normal life, an actual happy life. You want to know what Bruce had? An abusive father who tried to kill him several times.
Yeah.
And who murdered his mother.
Yeah.
A legit thing, but nah. You know, the Hulk can't be about horror, Porky, which it was originally intended to be. Nah, the Hulk has to be all, you know, smart guy, dumb. It's so stupid. It is some of the stupidest shit. It's awful. I fucking hate it. I hate the MCU so much. I hate it. It's bad.
It's like, I hate that it got revealed in this way, like, in front of the whole world.
I love how they have to create problems to make a Hulk to be right, but they softball these problems to still put it in Jen's favor. It's
yes
so annoying. Like,
that's
I don't have
stupid
any Hulk freakouts or anything, because I'm still pretty much normal but green, but it's still costing me jobs for some nonsensical fucking reason.
Well,
yeah, maybe I should have just let those people get smushed by that desk.
Sweetheart.
It's fucking Man of Steel logic over here.
Maybe I should have just let those people get smushed by that desk.
Maybe.
I'd like to offer you a job.
Is this a joke?
Yes, it is. The writing of this show is a joke on the audience.
Yeah, I would like women to come running out their fucking problems.
You got me fired, now you want to hire me.
Yeah, it would have been better and made more sense.
Bitter fucking spinsters doing this shit.
She got fired because he set it up because he wanted her for himself, for his company, and burned her with every law firm in the city. That actually would have been fine. Because yeah, that would
we
make
didn't
sense.
Do that.
We just started.
Logic
a
is out the window here.
Law division,
men are bad.
And I want you,
men
well,
are bad.
The She-Hulk, to be the face of it. That means I'll expect
family bad,
you
man
to be
bad,
at work
all bad.
And in court as the She-Hulk.
Like, oh, you didn't explain this shit to me before I walked in here all dressed up with my suitcase. Like, now you tell me I'm a diversity hire. Now you tell me that.
Have a gamma lawyer.
This way, please.
You think a law firm that specializes in superhuman disputes wouldn't be so surprised to see...
Yeah, that's a good point. They really shouldn't.
Bitch ...and being in a world where superheroes fucking exist. But
yes.
This is She-Hulk, and we have to be stupid to make things work.
That's really weird to me, too. You know, Marvel always does this whole thing of like, oh, yes, our superheroes are normal. Then why the fuck are these people acting confused? It's normal. Like, they have fucking alien invasions and shit. No, it's fine. Right, Porky? It's fine.
Yep.
Logic is
no, totally.
Out the window.
This sucks. I am totally qualified, but now everyone around here is always going to think this is the only reason I got the job. These dodos never had to deal with this on their first day at work.
They're not mutants! Like, why? Well, of course not!
Actually, she's technically
about,
a mutate.
Like, some of the women
she
of color you passed in the hallway. They never had to deal with being a 7-foot green monster. Of course not! It's not because they're white men, it's just because they're human beings.
What do you think about it?
I'm agnostic.
Well, I think I have a cream.
Believe in things, bitch.
I'm a banana.
I just found out the only reason they hired me is because they wanted a Hulk lawyer in the superhuman law division.
Yes, but look at everything it's getting us.
Yeah, tokenism, it's bad, but
yeah,
look
but,
at
look,
all
this stuff.
But look,
yeah, look at all this stuff.
There'd be some kind of commentary on tokenism, but this is the same show that said catcalling more traumatic than everything the Hulk has ever been through. Because woman, considering that Marvel is now the face of tokenism, of course they wouldn't see anything wrong with this.
No.
I'm gonna have to buy an entirely new wardrobe just to come to work.
I'm gonna have to buy a whole
new
wardrobe.
You've
like,
got a
your
salary!
Wardrobe seems to be
you've
you
got
just
a
fine.
Big one
Everywhere
being a
go,
lawyer. What are you complaining about?
Office.
Hi there, I'm Pug.
I'm your residential
You've got an office bigger than like
supplies to get you started,
90% of the people
snacks,
in this country's home.
A map to the best bathroom for pooping.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's not weird. I totally don't think that you have a toilet cam just waiting for my puckered hole.
Like, I wanted to see women pooping.
The best bathroom for pooping. I'm all for hospitality, but that's just weird.
Your first case is the parole of Emil Blonsky.
I would much prefer to be assigned literally any other case at this firm.
You don't get that choice as a lawyer.
You don't have a job here.
I mean,
you get what
you
get.
He's the only reputable actor in the shit.
Unless you prove yourself to win cases, you do not get that privilege.
Welcome to New Detroit. Like, this is very 80s to 90s dystopia shit.
Oh, where's RoboCop?
Welcome.
That seems very dangerous.
Yeah.
Like, what if it doesn't sense you in time? What if you try to run through it way too fast? Why can't it just, I don't know, fucking turn on and off? Like, why can't you just turn it off
while
you...
Makes a scary function pointless.
Fuck it!
The prisoner is a very dangerous man.
You gonna serve me up with some fava beans and a nice
piano? Yeah.
Shut the fuck up. If I wanted to hear movie references, I'd take my black ass to MCU Twitter.
Jennifer Waters.
Waters.
Conflict of interest.
Mr. Blonsky,
well, lawyer, I,
guess, I
but,
was expecting...
Yeah.
Abomination, right?
Yes.
That's who he is.
Well, yeah, stupid. Do you not remember things that you just learned a minute ago?
Do not step past the yellow lines.
Is your idiot brain getting fucked by stupid?
I'm so
fucked by stupid. That guy's a good guy. I don't care. I don't even watch this show, but every meme I see of him, I'm like, wait a minute.
Understand why
a
white man with
he's
a British accent has a Russian name? Does he just point it out for the dullards?
Actually, Walter is Russian. I don't know why he doesn't have a fucking Russian accent. That's dumb.
Okay.
We have 7 soulmates that I met through the prison pen pal program.
He's just playing the same character that they had the...
Wow.
I think it was the Edward Norton movie.
Just, like, I think, yeah. How do you not have anything to say? Like,
but Abomination is a fucking Hulk villain.
Your whole fucking job is talking and being charismatic.
But then you went on a destructive rampage in Harlem.
Or was it the Eric Bana movie? I don't even remember.
Yeah, because they pumped me full of that super soldier serum.
That you wanted.
Yeah, if I could take what I know now, put it in the body I had 10 years ago.
That would be someone I wouldn't want to fight.
I could probably arrange
something like that. Oh, hey, Ross. How you doing?
The serum the government gave you caused your subsequent actions?
I thought I was the good guy.
What? What? It's abomination.
It's so tiresome.
And they cut to shit from the Hulk movies they've made. And yep. It shows he's not. He's a fucking villain. He's a mercenary. He's not a good guy. It's abomination. I hate everything. I hate everything so much. This is what happens, Porky. They come for everything you've ever known and ruin it. It feels great, don't get me wrong, but it hurts when you know and then you see it. You see it butchered before you. Like, think of something you really love, right? Then imagine someone taking out a bunch of knives and cutting it up and putting it back together. Say, do you love it now? Yeah, yep. That's this.
Target's on the move. I thought
Abomination
gonna be,
is a heartless asshole.
I thought it was gonna be the good guy.
Captain Bloody America.
No.
What you better have been.
From their own shit. Their own shit. Wow.
Yep.
Talk about not knowing anything of your source material when you're writing a character. Woo. That is so bad. I know I'm using logic,
like,
but
you've
still,
got a little
he's
something
a bad guy.
Already,
it's Abomination.
I don't know what you've
he
got.
He kills people
you
on the regular because he's a mercenary.
The mixture could be an abomination. I didn't say I was unwilling.
I thought I was the good guy.
This nigga was clearly lying.
I mean, I want to believe that he is manipulating her right now, or the writers just don't know what the fuck happened in that film. I want to give the show the benefit of a doubt, but I've seen too much. I've seen too much incompetence.
Hey, Jen, what's up?
What's up?
Oh, God.
Open up your mouth, nigga.
Actually, Blonsky wrote me a really nice letter a while back.
And a really heartfelt haiku. So we put everything...
I really, really fucking hate Mark Ruffalo so much. I hate the people that also came up with Nerd Hulk as a thing, because that's stupid. That's a stupid idea.
No, it's not even the Hulk anymore. It's just...
No, it's just
green...
Mark Ruffalo.
Mark Ruffalo, yeah.
Yeah, it's just Mark Ruffalo is this fucking, like, nerd. Fuck off. It's awful. I mean, it was in the comics, too. Like, the Hulk has, like, multiple personas. It's, like, a fucking borderline personality disorder shit, right? That's what causes that. But it doesn't go to that extent ever, and when they have written it, it's bad. There are other characters that are a lot more likable, like Mr. Fix-It, shit like that. It's awful. It's just bad. I don't like it.
Behind us.
Yeah, we destroyed Harlem so together. He was bloodthirsty and had a lust for power. But he sent me a fucking haiku, and we're good.
God. You coming to L.A. anytime soon?
Yeah, no. Probably not for a minute. I got some things I gotta take care of.
I hate it.
Dun, 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 dun. It's like, okay.
Same
who gives a fuck?
Yeah.
That made them crash into the woods is the same one he's on now in space. So wait, what?
What?
So when they crashed, did the people in the ship come down and like pick him up? And then send him home? And then they picked him up again later? After Jen left? Tell me the mechanics of that. I don't understand that.
Showing the Abomination participating in what
showing
appears
the
to be
you want to know
an
the Abomination,
fight club
Porky?
After
it's
having
Latin
somehow
spring
escaped from
Abomination
prison.
Oh, that sucks.
I agree with the hideous crone.
Weak.
I'm sorry.
Previously, like we know. Stop showing this shit. Like we already know how dumb this was. You don't need to explain it again. Yeah, that's still not safe.
Who forced you to escape this insanely high security prison undetected?
A sorcerer supreme of the mystic arts, and his name is
Mega Faggot.
Sorcerer who lives in New York, or a librarian who lives in Nepal?
Oh, he's got a LinkedIn or whatever.
Why does he have a LinkedIn?
Isn't it funny? This is going to be painful to say, but Jimmy Kimmel did this joke, and he did it better. Because it actually fit the situation. It was a good setup.
Whoa, what is it? No. No vanquishing. Just pull a rabbit out of somewhere. Do tricks.
A rabbit?
Yeah. Look, I think there's been a misunderstanding. I don't
also,
know.
Also, Benedict Cumberbatch is a fucking asshole, too.
The mightiest magician in the cosmos.
Like, LinkedIn.
Not everyone exaggerates their LinkedIn profile.
That's actually funny. But this is just like, oh, sorcerer doesn't, person
okay.
on LinkedIn.
So British people really, really try with American accents, right? They try to make it sound natural. Yeah. That still doesn't sound natural to me. It sounds forced as fuck.
Yeah.
He tries.
I
mean, we do. I mean, we can't do their accents either, but that's because we're not, you know, British.
Yeah.
We never will be.
That's it.
Can you get
to him? People that are close look like
yes,
fucking Cobra.
It's me. Of course I can get to him. I sent a thirst trap. It was a picture of me with a bunch of books.
That's a bunch of books with your
British
titties
genetics hanging
out? Just because he's a sorcerer doesn't mean he don't like some big ass milkers.
I know you can't wait to see Wong.
Watch the road, because the last
you
time you
bitch.
Did it, you nearly killed yourself and your cousin. And what was that music cuts?
What is that?
I know you can't wait to see Wong.
No, we just saw the Multiverse of Madness. We're all full up on Wong, okay?
I just want to make sure that you don't think this is one of those cameo every week type of shows. Well, except Bruce.
Okay, we get...
And Wonsky. And Wong.
See, it's funny because...
okay. So She-Hulk in the comics breaks the fourth wall all the time, right? Right? But that's not something that happened right away with her. That took time. That took time to happen. You want to know what else she did originally in the comics, Porky? She was literally just a female version of the Hulk. Like, the same Hulk smash shit, but a woman. That's it.
Yep. Yeah.
It took other writers to make her what she is in this portrayal of her. Time. Effort. Shit, it's a lot of stuff.
Yeah,
no.
Well, but I mean, this show
no,
probably
of course.
Doesn't have that kind of time.
No, of course they're not gonna. I understand that. It's just, it's painful. It's very painful.
Yeah, I mean...
If writers actually do depend on shameless cameos in order to prop up
impressive.
A show that would otherwise
yeah,
be fucking canceled
do.
After the first couple of episodes because it sucks. See, our incompetence is funny. We put more effort into that instead of actually trying to not be incompetent.
Just remember whose show this actually is.
Sweetie, we're just waiting for Matt Murdock to show up, so cut out all that smug bullshit, please.
Ew, why does he look like that?
That's not what Abomination should look like.
Why is his head so much smaller than the rest of him?
Excuse me, everyone. I have more shit to read. She-Hulk, not real. Superhero hoax. What? And it only has 214 views. For one
on
thing,
YouTube.
They wouldn't recommend you these videos right here. These would not be up front in the related videos. Why are they here? Superhero hoax, which doesn't make sense because they live in a universe where superheroes exist. So if she were to pop up, it would not be a huge deal. Like, they tried to do this shit with Supergirl. It didn't make sense then, and it doesn't make sense now. You're a woman. How could you be a superhero?
In our world, I'll hashtag the big green woman.
People would have come up with
the
a
big
much
green woman.
The jolly green Gina. Come on. Put it right there. We got to have affirmative action with superheroes.
Dom the
no
bounty hunter.
Superheroes, please. Why are you turning every superhero into a girl? Nobody asked for it. This doesn't even make sense in context of the show.
No.
Because superheroes exist in this world. It's different from actually scripting a fictional show, gender swapping and all this type of shit just to get woke points because you don't want people to notice how bad the writing is. It's a fucking difference. Why everything gotta be female now? This doesn't make sense. So we have a Me Too movement and now all the male heroes are gone. The writers are morons.
Yes,
oh
they
my
are.
God.
It was dirty.
I don't know about y'all, but I'd smash.
That's the only thing that's actually internet accurate. I'd fuck that disgusting green bitch.
I'd smash that bitch.
What the
fuck? What is that? Why is she dressed like an Undertaker or Lurch?
This reminds me of something. Hang on, let me find it. Let me find it. There it is. There it is. Oh my god. David Byrne with a jolly green Gina head. What is with that? She just had a form-fitting suit on an episode ago. And now she's look like she's wearing her daddy's suit. The fuck? And the way she walks is
terrible.
Yeah,
she turns her
what
shoulder
kind of
weird.
Oh no, what it looks like to me? The funeral is about to begin, Porky.
Yeah.
Tall man shit. The fucking suit that doesn't fit.
Oh, yeah.
What the hell? The CGI is better, guys. Remember, the CGI is better now. Because
yes,
it just
better.
You got a fucking Tesla, a nice apartment. I mean, you're a lawyer. See a tailor.
For fuck's sake, really.
You lanky bitch! Oh, that is bad CGI right there. You see, like,
look at the contrast.
Mm-hmm. Is also in the superhuman lot of it.
Yeah. No, I can't talk to a 10 about embarrassing man stuff. She could be my next fiance.
You know, it's really hard to take
the themes of sexism
against women seriously.
Whenever... I know who that fucking character is now. That's fucking Man-Wolf.
Who, no, Star Wolf.
He is J. Jonah Jameson's son, actually. He's an astronaut. He eventually goes into space and gets powers from there. Yeah.
Every example of sexism is fucking over the top and ridiculous to the point where you just roll your eyes and you're like, yeah, that doesn't happen. I'm completely shutting down and ignoring
it. I think that's who that's supposed to be.
Y'all don't take it seriously, so why should anyone else take it seriously? Like, really? Yeah. Like I said, it's like American Psycho, but they're probably trying to make that dude clever satire and humor just...
Sucked right out of it. Most morally good person. He was a hero, technically, though.
What?
Astronaut.
Sorry, you thought
American
you were dating
hero,
Megan the Stallion?
What part of shapeshifter did you not get?
Oh, he is. That is him.
And I thought
he's a shapeshifter. That's him. Holy shit.
CGI. This is the part of the episode that pissed me off because it's clear that he was actually like really taken advantage of. It's not like he was talking with this chick over the internet and never seen what she looked like or met her in person. It's a different thing than someone shapeshifting and making you believe there's someone else. He was like manipulated by magic. How the fuck is a normal person supposed to know that they're being manipulated by magic? What kind of like irritates me is that if this were a female character who got duped into thinking she was dating Henry Cavill in person and then they fucked several times and he extorted money from her, there we would have to have sympathy for this character. But because it's a guy and it's Dennis, who's barely even a character, he's barely even a speck on a piece of paper. That's how one-dimensional he is. We're supposed to think, oh, isn't that funny? Now I'm hoping, I'm praying that they did not sleep together. Now, if they did, that opens up a whole new can of worms. And that's going to piss me off.
I extracted him from the prison against his own wishes because I required a worthy opponent as part of my training to become Sorcerer Supreme.
Okay, wait. So to become Sorcerer Supreme, you have to battle one mutant against another? What?
That's dumb.
I didn't see Shang-Chi because I didn't give a single
shit. Because
it's
bad.
He had to battle somebody.
And I was like, I mean, y'all got this second-rate asshole to just imitate Jackie Chan. I could just watch the real Jackie Chan. Fuck off. Plus, it didn't look like the plot made that much sense. That's a whole different story. Let's continue.
I am not the one who will be punishing him. The parole board will not release him after seeing this video.
We'll send him to the mirror dimension.
I don't know what that is, but no.
Shadow dimension?
Like, Wong doesn't know what jails are. Like, I understand, like, he's a sorcerer and he spends most of his time being a sorcerer, but he doesn't know what jail is. He doesn't know what, like, laws are. He's drinking a Red Bull. It's funny. Because he's a douchebag. It's funny.
Funny.
I love harassing women in the workplace. It's
what?
Kick.
God, this is the dumbest shit I've ever seen.
Let that be a warning.
What?
I don't. You guys know me.
Yeah, see, if they did know you, you wouldn't have to say that. Especially since we saw you walk out after the other you transformed into an old crone. Like, we get it.
If I could, Matt. Clarify?
No.
Blair, Ruth, Marta, Sheila, Alejandra...
Brenda, Leticia.
Linda, Felicia, Dawn, LaShawn.
Donnell, and Alicia.
He has wives. He's got polyamorous shit. I don't know what that
is. I'm lawyering.
The witness will explain. If he ever decides to show up.
I know you want to leave me. The fucking way he read it at Mike, that was so David Ruffin.
Excuse me, Your Honor, but Asgard is not a place. It is a people. Therefore,
Thor's inspirational speeches are not admissible in court.
Okay, that was fun.
My client and Mr. Bukowski were in a consensual relationship and engaged in role play.
Oh, gross.
Role play?
A rational adult would have believed my client's texts were from the real Megan Thee Stallion. Mr. Bukowski knew he was dating Miss Runa and went along with it until it no longer suited him.
Okay, so they fucking clearly state that they had a sexual fucking relationship. they kind of make it seem like he just texted her, but I'm like, he spent $175,000 on someone that he never saw in person. That sounds like horseshit. So yeah. It's kind of fuzzy whether or not they fucked in real life. I don't know, but if they did, that's like sexual assault and possibly rape.
Yeah.
And yeah. But then if they didn't have sex and it was just like an online thing, that's kind of stupid because, like, why wouldn't you just meet him in person and make him think that you were actually Megan Thee Stallion? It'd be a lot easier if you, like, laid it on him. Like, it'd still be unethical and rape. But why just deceive him over text when you can literally fucking shapeshift? The reason people dupe other people over text or Instagram or something like that is because they cannot do what you do. They cannot make themselves into who they're impersonating, so they got to do it in a shady way. So what? Like, but you have superpowers. Why the fuck wouldn't you meet him in person? I guess they knew, like, yeah, we can't condone rape, even if it is a man. So we got to make it seem like it's over text, but that doesn't work. A woman would get a lot more sympathy than this. I just saw a fucking article, two articles, talking about women being duped by a Henry Cavill Instagram account and how they funneled money to the guy, despite him, of course, not being the real Henry Cavill.
No shit.
When it's a woman, like, people do reports on this saying, oh, this poor woman got duped, but him, he should have known better, he should have been smarter, blah, blah, blah. Which I do agree
all
at
his
some
fault.
Level,
he's
but would that show extend that same tough love to a woman? I don't think so.
Impersonating a judge is illegal. Get down from there.
How did no one see her do that?
Excuse me? If I could just put your minds at ease.
Emil, no.
It's fine. Jen.
It's fine.
I don't want people to see how bad our CGI really is. Please don't do it. Like, this frame right here just tells me that Tim Roth is taking the piss. He does not.
That is Tim Roth.
Yeah, of course it is.
Oh, God. I mean, of course
that's,
it is.
Yeah, because they took him from the other movie.
I forgot he played fucking Abomination. Oh, my God.
Yeah.
From Reservoir Dogs, we've fallen so far, huh, boy?
Yeah.
Mr. fucking Orange. Look at us now. God, it's a living.
Like, he's like, I'm making myself big. I'm inflating like a balloon, man. Yeah, and they just cut away because they don't want to spend the money on the effect that it would take to show him transform. Hilarious.
As you can see, I'm in full control.
His voice sounds the exact same as the before.
It shouldn't.
They just don't give a fuck anymore.
You realize that you've just admitted to facilitating a prisoner escape, which is a crime.
I must depart.
I must depart. I'm leaving.
All right, that was funny. That was funny.
And then I get to my car, and some.
See, that's almost funny enough where it could be a joke.
Monster,
like it could be a meme.
You're telling me as a lawyer, that could be like a meme. Experienced that before? Like maybe you defended a rapist, armed robber, Hunter Biden.
I don't want this. Oh my god.
Oh my god. I'm such a nothing character. She doesn't do a fucking thing. But. Give positive reassurance to our lead character. She's just completely useless.
Good God, Dennis Bukowski.
Oh, yeah. No, you're gonna need that.
Connecting the A and B story. Nice.
Her fourth wall breaks aren't even funny. They feel more like little reminders for the low attention span fans of the show. Where's the joke
pay attention.
There isn't one! We're connecting the A and B plot. Duh. Like, no shit. You got anything to add to that?
How did you two work with him for so long?
The man is almost... terminally deluded.
He's terminally deluded, but like she thinks she's better than the Hulk. Yeah, he is the only terminally deluded one in this cast. Okay.
Yes, clearly.
Would you be willing to say that under oath?
I don't like your face. I don't like you. I don't like your presence.
I just realized that my volume on my headphones is at like 22 instead of 40.
He once described himself as
so this is
going to
be a quiet,
10 and an
quiet
LA 11.
We did, I guess.
My interview sound fine.
Objection. Yeah. Relevance.
And if he's so delusional, why doesn't he just like accept what she's saying? Like, yeah, I'm awesome. Like, that's what someone like him would do. Like, my office is the dentosphere, bitch. Like, but he's not. He's like getting defensive. Like, when someone like him would not get defensive.
It's not right for a woman to read. Soon she starts getting ideas and thinking.
Yes, he is a Gaston type.
You are positively primal.
Everyone loves Gaston.
Thank you, Belle.
Do you?
Yeah,
think
exactly.
The Dennis
that's how this guy would act.
Believe that he could actually pull Megan, the Stallion.
Is Megan the Stallion such a fucking elegant prize that she wouldn't go for some
douchebag? I don't even know who that is.
Who would spend over $100,000 on her and then that she would later dump? She literally lied that someone shot her in the fucking foot. She tried to frame a man for aggravated assault.
A man's career had been completely derailed as a result of something that was said by this superstar, Megan Thee Stallion. He was blackballed from the industry. One of his best albums he ever put together didn't even make it on the new releases page on Spotify. All because of what one woman said. Nobody seemed to care about the fact that the woman, her best friend that was in their car, along with Megan Thee Stallion, along with Tory Lanez, for some reason didn't come out and confirm Megan's story. Very strange. Recently, Megan Thee Stallion went and got on some interview, and she got on there, she did the crocodile tears, you feel me? Said that Tory Lanez shot her. However, new information is coming out today. Dr. Lofredo, who treated Megan Thee Stallion, confirmed her foot was wounded due to her stepping on glass.
Yes.
Wow.
Did you shoot with her?
I did, and it was, you know, the best day of my life. It was so great. Like, she's really, like, this regal, smart, wonderful actor, and just, like, powerful.
Wow. Is your idiot brain getting fucked by stupid?
You expect me to believe that Megan Thee Stallion, this pure, chaste woman, would have gone for his scraggly ass? Yes.
We also sentenced the defendant to 60 days. For impersonating a judge.
Only 60 days for impersonating a judge? That doesn't
make
sense.
That's a pretty high crime there, judge.
But then again, the showrunner and writers have stated that they don't know how to fucking write law shit.
No.
So it's not that
surprising. No, they don't.
That's right. There's only one Megan
Thee Stallion. No, because you need someone in the writing room who knows how to do procedural stuff.
Should I go back?
No, please don't.
Actually, you dodged an even bigger bullet not being with the real Megan Thee Stallion.
Yeah.
I wish there was a way we could remove her powers and make sure she doesn't victimize anyone else.
Did Dennis Mikowski just give me an idea?
I have an idea. Stop using these fourth wall breaks to announce obvious fucking plot points that we just heard and actually have a joke. That's Faith. She looks like if someone was letting the air out of Sigourney Weaver. Look at her. As much as I hate this show, it's given me a lot of laughs.
We hereby grant Mr. Blonsky's release on parole effective immediately. As a condition of his parole,
he's a murderer.
Mr. Blonsky is prohibited from turning into abomination indefinitely. And
how is that going
to
stop him?
Is ordered to wear an inhibitor in perpetuity.
Oh, so wait, now the inhibitor is like an in-universe thing? Now this technology is just common? When before it was supposed to be a prototype specifically for Bruce, now it's for him.
Okay, sure.
Just right.
Sure.
It's like, use a brain cell before you do it.
She-Hulk.
Yeah, my name's Jennifer Walters.
She-Hulk.
12 seconds later.
How did you come up with the name She-Hulk?
Oh, funny story. I didn't. Some random guy on the news came up with it. So now whether I like it or not, I am forever She-Hulk.
Then why the fuck did you correct him a minute ago?
She-Hulk shares her diet and exercise secrets.
I'm sorry. What?
Okay, that wasn't funny, but you know what would have been funny? If he had said, oh, She-Hulk, and by the way, we would just love to know your dieting and exercise secrets. And it would have been funny if she came back with, gamma radiation.
Yeah.
And then it just cut away. That would have been funny.
That would have been funny. That comes with good writing.
No, yeah, that would have been first,
Where the hell was that?
First generation.
Because it doesn't look like anywhere she is. Plus, you have the early
Iron Man movies had that kind of humor.
There's no way she wouldn't have seen you. You were right there. He literally launched himself into her arms. He just went head first into her arm. That is so dumb. It's like she doesn't even have to try to do anything because everyone else around her is so stupid. And I don't understand why Asgardian technology wouldn't hurt her. It doesn't seem to be putting a dent in her at all. I mean, I don't know, maybe magic doesn't hurt people with gamma radiation, but I don't know, it just doesn't make sense to me. Because I remember specifically Hulk getting booyasted by Thor's hammer. So the fact that she's not really being hurt here is just like... So what, they were trying to extract her blood? Why? Is the Candyman about to pop up? What the fuck is this music?
Just your signature there.
Oh no, is the twerking gonna happen?
That was the only good thing about the Candyman remake was the music.
Oh, there it is!
Turn it off.
Yeah.
You are way more fun than my last lawyer. I will kill for you, Megan Thee Stallion. Dial it back.
Alright. Alright, stop for a bit. Alright, there's a lot of shit wrong with that I don't think a lot of people realize. Like, of course, we can look at it and just say, oh, hey, scene cringy. But there's a lot more wrong with this. Yeah. Jennifer Walters is specifically supposed to cater to superhuman people. That's why they hired her in the first place. But she's representing Megan Thee Stallion now. Is Megan Thee Stallion some kind of mutant that we don't... Well, she probably is. It doesn't yeah. make sense that she's being represented. Her, whatever. One second, they're like signing papers, and then the next, they're dancing and twerking together to her music. Which is tacky. It's like, what happened in between? Because there's no, like, dialogue no. or yeah. camaraderie between the two while they're signing the papers. It just goes from one scene Jesus. To the next. And also, she was complaining about not being taken seriously
as
a lawyer because she's a woman and whatnot. But she's up in here twerking in her office to loud fucking music in front of her entire firm. They yeah. all can see yep. her. Like, it's a very spacious and open... We can see that shit. Even her boss sees her. Not to mention, like, we just had an episode where we were supposed to feel very afraid for this woman being catcalled and sexually harassed by men.
Now and then she's does
just,
that.
Like I said, just twerking. It kind of goes against the messaging this show was trying to convey. I mean, the catcalling scene already was kind of hypocritical because she had to get dressed up like a whore in order for these men to get into their mind that they could... catcall her as if what she was wearing was inviting that level of attention. They're yeah. already like inconsistent with what they're trying to say, so it's not that far off that they'd be inconsistent again. I mean, I'd be humiliated if my boss walked in on me opening and closing my cheeks and jiggling it in front of my I'd be fucking humiliated. Let's get down yeah. to the twerking thing and why that doesn't work.
Yeah.
It's like you're buffing a rocking chair with your ass. It doesn't especially the look on her face, which is just horrifying.
It's
and
really
she's wearing
horrifying.
That same fucking David Byrne suit from earlier. She had no ass in that suit. So I feel like the animators had to go in and expand her ass a little bit so it would look like Megan Thee Stallion's. I'm like, are you wearing men's shoes? What the fuck is that? Can you imagine just like animating this horse shit?
I will kill for you, Megan Thee Stallion.
Dial it back.
Okay, and then there's that. Apparently, like, what brought on this whole thing was Tatiana Maslany is also a big fan of Megan Thee Stallion. Coincidentally. I guess they kind of incorporated that into She-Hulk's character. But the thing is, it looks a lot less funny
so it's just
obsessive
a vanity project
and more
for the
scary
100%.
Obsessive. I look at the look on her face and her clenching her fist like that. I mean, look, she's got the Arthur fist. She's so
she
imposing
does.
Over her. Like, it's not funny.
The punchy
it's just,
DW.
Like, yeah, dial it back. Stop. Don't do that. I feel like you're going to rip my tits off. And also, Megan Thee Stallion can't act her way out of a paper bag.
Nope.
She sucks. Like, how do you fucking fail at acting like yourself? And, like, you could have given her a better role than this. A better role than herself. Yaddy, 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 yaddy. Anyway, yeah, this sucks. This is fucking terrible. Yeah, so overall, episode 3, yeah, we're back on track with the bullshit. And I feel like it's only going to get worse from here because we still got to bring in Matt Murdock. And we know that's going to be a shit show. We know he's going to get ruined.
They're gonna
they can't even
him.
Write courtroom mm-hmm. scenes, obviously. And
then
you're going to have...
All right, here's the thing, though, Porky. Matt Murdock is handicapped because he's blind.
Yeah.
So who wins the Challenge Olympics now, huh?
He's obviously, still a white man.
Yes, it's obviously the white Jewish woman that turns green.
Yeah.
Not the poor no. white Jewish boy who can't see, right? Actually, no. He's Irish. I shouldn't say that he's Irish. He's not Jewish.
Yeah.
I got that confused.
One of the best fucking lawyers, not only in the MCU, but on television, to
yep.
do, like, lawyer scenes? This isn't going to end well.
No.
This isn't gonna, and considering the tone of the show, it's just, how does it... No.
No.
No. I think the death nail for this show... is going to be when they introduce Matt Murdock.
It
we
is.
We still have defenders of this show, despite all of the garbage. There are still people who think this is a good show. But I think
like
Matt
Joe,
Murdock
Angry
is going
Joe
to
does.
Break the conditioning. It's going to wake a lot of people the fuck up. If it doesn't, then God help us all.
Then I'm going
to
wake Joe
the channel,
up. He's a fucking simp.
I'm on Subscribestar now. Or you can donate to my PayPal, whichever works for you. Or you can like the video, subscribe, you know, do all that shit. But yeah, thanks for watching, and bye.
Probably won't go the way of Batwoman. I won't be surprised.
Yeah. Probably.
Yeah. Let's see if there's anything else here. With the supportive stuff. Nope. Okay. So with that, we come to the end of this dark room. I'd like to thank everyone for sticking around, and Porky obviously joined me as my co-host for this. It was always fun. And I'm going to do a little shilling like I always do, and then we'll be done. Don't forget the movie caption contest, movie picture, movie hammer going on in the Discord, so be sure to play those. Don't forget to join me and Porky tomorrow at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time in the Discord for the boys, because we're going to be hosting two more horror movies. It's all spooky month, till actually Halloween, so be sure to tune in for us doing double features then. And Sunday, I'm not doing a show with Weeb, or there's not the seats open. What's going to be happening instead is just a Discord exclusive, so be sure to tune in for that as well at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time.